Marshall to start, and he gets nowhere. Buck Jones came in. Bilal Nichols was there. I think I saw Bell and Reeder. So you talk about the inside guys, all three of them, Nichols, Bell, Reeder, in on that stop.
And JMU going into about a 20 to 25 mile an hour wind, so that'll help Delaware. They can cheat up with the safeties.
Second and seven. They give Marshall 3 yards on his first carry as Shore awaits the snap. And there was some movement for James Madison. They'll go backwards. We'll hear it.
First snap, full start. Number 60 on the offense. That's a 5-yard penalty. Second down.
James Madison, and this is something to watch throughout, is last and second to last in FCS in penalty yards this season. They get penalized a lot. And there's the first one on what would have been the second snap of the game. So Brian Shore lines up now second and 12 from his own 23, and they'll go to Marshall again up the middle, and again Marshall not getting much. The Blue Hens are fired up. They are ready for this one, and Coach Rocco talked about how important the middle is to shore up, and so far after two plays, the Hens doing just that.
Well, the other thing about it, Scott, is, you know, there was a little bit of an embarrassment factor last year. JMU really took them behind the woodshed. Delaware's a better defense than that. They were determined to prove themselves here this afternoon.
James Madison, sixth best third down offense in the country, and a timeout's being taken by James Madison at 13:52 in the first quarter. This Delaware defense is fired up, and a big third down coming with the ball on their own 25-yard line. So Mike Houston calling a timeout.
Well, the other thing that'll be very important to keep an eye on here this afternoon, Scott, will be the way that Delaware matches JMU's substitution patterns. We saw the Dukes, after that second down stop, try to run some personnel onto the field, so Delaware gets the opportunity to substitute. JMU runs a very fast-paced offense, so they tax you both physically and mentally, and Delaware's got to be clean with the line shifts. It's almost like a hockey game where you're changing on the move, and there's a guy in the coaching staff who is in charge up top of yelling down to the sideline. They're switching. We can go ahead and counter. And it was not a clean switch from JMU, believe it or not, there. That's why they had to take the timeout. They did not have the right personnel package on the field.
JMU, 1:08 into the game, uses their first timeout, third down and 10. JMU converts third downs 55% of the time on the season. This one, third and long. Shore takes a few steps, throws in the direction of Troy Reeder, and he picked it off. Troy Reeder makes it happen defensively for the Hens on a third down and 10, and Delaware will start on James Madison's side of the field.
They're trying to go to Terrence Alls, who's just back from suspension, playing in his first game of the season. Scott, it's a little crossing pattern over the middle, and a great job by Reeder to open up as he backpedaled, started to his right, and then had to cut across the center of the field. And then just a fantastic play as he tipped that football and then was able to secure it. Not a great throw from Shore. A little bit behind Alls, which certainly helped Reeder's cause, but a fantastic catch there by a linebacker, dropping, moving lateral, and still able to make the hands catch.
Beautiful job by Reeder as Walker will start under center, first and 10 from the James Madison 42-yard line. Jarman goes in motion, play action. Walker going for it up the middle, and it's almost intercepted right back. Wow. Rashad Robinson, who already has 3 picks on the season, had that between the twos. Difficult catch to make as he was diving to the turf. That could have been an interception right back.
Well, Delaware taking the shots unchanged there and trying to catch JMU's defense a little bit slow getting ready. And they tried to fake end around to Jarman, fake then to Jefferson, and just good job by the safety to stay back.
Walker will go out of the pistol with Kareem Williams getting the start today after 100 yards rushing against Cornell. Yoakum goes in motion, and the give is to Williams with some good blocking as he gets to the 40-yard line. A pickup of 2 yards. It'll be third down and about 8 to go.
Brandon Hifford able to chase that play down from behind, and that is one of the real struggles against this Dukes defense, their pursuit. They are so quick to the football, and Yoakum did a pretty good job. He got out and took the outside linebacker out of the play, but the guy from the other side was able to get involved and run it down.
Herford's been waiting to make his first tackle. He was suspended the first 4 games of the season. He had 8 tackles last year against Delaware. Gets his first there. Third down and 8. Ball at the James Madison 40. No score. First possession for Delaware. Here comes pressure. Walker has to get rid of it. as no one picked up the blitzer, Curtis Oliver, coming from the left side.
Yeah, corner blitz that time. And I think that one's on Walker. He's got to get rid of that football just a tad sooner. You can't really account for a corner blitz, and he had a lot of ground to cover there. Just about a half count late getting rid of the football, but better to not make a mistake, throw the football away there, than to risk an interception, play the field position game, especially with the wind favoring the Hens.
So Delaware can't take advantage of the interception by Troy Reeder. We'll see Pritchard with a punt. It'll bounce at the 10, and right at the inch line was Jamie Jarman, I believe, but he went back into the end zone. Couldn't stay. In fact, that was Tenny Adewusi who got there, and he went into the end zone, so it will be a touchback, and that'll send us to our first timeout. 12:45, a lot of action in the first couple minutes of this football game. We'll take a break. Your PNC Bank timeout score, nothing. Duke's football when we come back.
Hi, I'm Matthew Kersey.
The official bird of Delaware isn't red. It's not green or purple. It's blue. Coincidence? We think not. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware. This blue hen does not need to see a podiatrist. But if he did, waiting for a referral might get his feathers in a bunch. And he wouldn't like that one bit. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware.
Hi guys, it's great to be here.
In the desert.
At the mall.
On the mountain.
At school.
At the beach.
In the Big Easy.
Yeah.
Today I want to show you guys the next gen Chevy Equinox. What do you think?
That's pretty.
Pretty sexy.
It's all wheel drive, look at that.
It looks aggressive.
But not overbearing.
It's not too big, not too small.
Looks like it could go off-roading.
But at the same time, it looks like a car you could take to a nice event.
You can dress it up or dress it down.
Seems like the perfect car for anybody.
I would take it anywhere.
I want one.
I love it.
She's a bad mamma jamma.
Chevy stepped their game up.
Dressed on the sideline, you love the effort, just you don't have to be quite so aggressive.
James Madison comes out with the football on their own 25. Second possession for JMU. Trey Sharp will go in motion. The running back to the right of Shore is Marshall. They'll throw the screen pass to the man in motion, Sharp, and there are four blue jerseys there to meet him. Bell, Reeder were there first, as well as Anthony Jackson, and this Delaware defense has been swarming thus far.
Well, you would think it is a good matchup for Delaware because they are excellent tacklers. The key to JMU is getting guys down in space, and so far Delaware has done it very effectively.
Trips to the left side for Brian Shore and his offense on second down and 9, and Marcus Marshall will gain the most yards he has thus far. 2 carries, 5 yards before that one. It got him about 6. It should be third down and 2 for James Madison. Looks like they want to go fast, speeding things up on third and 2 from their own 28. Awaiting the snap is Brian Shore. Now getting the snap is Brian Shore. Up the middle again, Marcus Marshall. It's going to be close. I believe he got momentum to the 30. That's where he needed to get to. And it should be a first down, as Blaine Woodson was there, as was Troy Reeder. They'll move the sticks, the first down of the day for the Dukes. This team, James Madison, leads the nation in first down offense. Nearly 28 first downs per game for James Madison. They've got the football at their own 30-yard line. The running back still, Marcus Marshall. And in motion goes Taylor Woods. It'll be Shore who keeps it right into Blaine Woodson. And picks up 4.5, maybe 5. That was a strong effort from a quarterback who certainly was much smaller than the 280-pound Blaine Woodson.
Hey, but he won leverage. Low man wins. And he got low on Woodson, was able to drive him forward a step or two. And you don't see that happen to Blaine Woodson very often.
Woodson, the fifth-year senior from Stroudsburg, Pennsylvania, former Rookie of the Year on the defensive side. Second down and five for James Madison. A big hole on that left side for Marcus Marshall as he gets to the 41. Ball comes loose. Delaware has the football. And it'll be Delaware football. The signal to the Hens. Cam Kitchen came up with it. And the second turnover forced as many possessions by the Hens.
I'll be interested to see if they take a look at that. The tackle on Marshall was being made. He was almost down to the ground. It looked like he tried to use his arm to keep himself up, and that's where the ball popped free. They have it up on the video board now, so if we get a good look at it. Pretty good tackle in space by Jackson, and then Bell ripping at the football. That is really close, the backside being down and up, but I think it started to move just a tad.
And on the scoreboard, we were able to watch the video. It looked like Buck Jones ripped it on the way down. And I think, as the call on the field, is a fumble recovery by Delaware. If they look at it, it should not be overturned. And if they did look at it, that was the call. We're back in action, and Delaware's offense is on the field. They'll start it around that 40-yard line. That's about where the interception by Troy Reeder happened. And the Hens under center with Joe Walker on 10, the JMU 40. Run up the gut, Bream Williams. And he was a Gus Little leg tackle away from a touchdown. There was no one else to beat. Gus Little, the transfer from Maryland, made the stop there, his 15th tackle of the season. A powerful run by Williams to make it second down and 7.
One of the shortest tacklers on the JMU defense, and Williams is good at shedding tackles, just couldn't work his way free.
Two tight ends on the right side for Walker. They'll run that way. Williams is hit as he gets to the 36-yard line. Kyrie Hawkins on the tackle. Gus Little was there. Good linebacking core from this JMU team. Kyrie Hawkins leads the squad, his 28th tackle of the season. And now quickly, third down and 6 for Delaware.
Yeah, we talked about Delaware trying to stay ahead of the sticks. Second possession, second time they've taken the football over in plus territory, and a second time they've had third down and long. I mean, this one is reasonable at third and 6, but this is not the situation, the down and distance Delaware wants to live in.
Delaware go trips to the left side. Scarf, Papali, and Cherry on third down and 6 from the JMU 36. No score in this football game. Walker looking for somebody. Good blocking. He has time as he moves around in the pocket. Now he just runs out of time as Andrew Ankra gets his fifth tackle for loss of the year. And the punt unit going to have to come back on.
They're trying to run a shallow cross to Jamie Jarman, and Joe Walker came out of it just a hair too soon. Now the pocket was starting to collapse, but if he holds his ground for even a quarter second longer, Jarman popped wide open. There was nobody with him. It would have been an easy first down. It would have been a lot more.
Delaware going to try a 55-yard field goal. Watch for something perhaps special on this one, because Frank Rago is out. They've got the win. Rago gives it a try. And Frank Rago drills it from 55 yards. Flag on the play.
It's offsides on JMU. They take
this
the
one
points,
might
probably
be against James Madison. A wind-aided 55-yarder. Let's hear the call.
Offsides, number 6 on the defense. Murphy is declined. Field goal is good.
The official's even fired up. He almost called it a touchdown. What a kick from Frank Rago. And we'll take a break with 9:05 remaining in quarter number 1. Your PNC Bank timeout score. Blue Hens 3, James Madison nothing.
UD Blue Hen football, powered by State Farm. There for you.
I just picked up the cake for the baby shower.
Yay! You know she's having a boy, right?
Oh boy.
Buick now has an SUV for that. Introducing the new Buick Encore.
I knew I could trust you guys with the cake.
Oh, no problem. That was close.
One of three luxury SUVs from the new Buick.
Get 17% below MSRP on almost every 2017 Encore model. That's over 5,500 on this Buick Encore.
Whether you're a morning person or simply it's not your thing, maybe you're the type that doesn't take it that seriously, or you're that person who just makes everyone's morning brighter. there's a McDonald's for every morning.
Enjoy a sausage burrito for $1 or a sausage McGriddle sandwich for $2. Pair it with any size freshly brewed McCafe hot coffee for $1.
Into the post to Nick Harrison.
We've all been there.
Can't even see the score.
Oh my God.
Trying to watch the game on that tiny screen. It's time to watch sports the way they were meant to be watched. On this, in high definition, you can now watch all your favorite teams and players on the big screen for free. With CAA.TV, you'll never miss a moment. Take back the living room by searching CAA on your device.
Hi guys, it's great to be here.
In the desert.
At the mall.
On the mountain.
At school.
At the beach.
In the Big Easy.
Yeah.
Today I want to show you guys the next gen Chevy Equinox. What do you think?
That's pretty.
Pretty sexy.
It's all wheel drive, look at that.
It looks aggressive.
But not overbearing. It's not too big, not too small.
Looks like it could go off-roading.
But at the same time, it looks like a car you could take to a nice event.
You can dress it up or dress it down.
Seems like the perfect car for anybody.
I would take it anywhere.
I want one.
I love it.
She's a bad mamma jamma.
Chevy stepped their game up.
You know, Delaware won the toss, and they deferred to the second half so they can take the wind and already paying dividends as Shore's been intercepted, throwing into the wind, and now Frank Rango gets a career-long 55 yards to put Delaware up 3-0 with 9:05 remaining in the first quarter. Penalty was offsides against JMU, so Delaware took the points. And now they'll be kicking off for the second time today. Last one from Jake Roth was a touchback. This one headed that direction as well, and it's into the bushes, almost into the student section off the leg of Jake Roth, who gets touchbacks about 65% of the time. He kicks it off.
What a big field goal, though, Scott. In all seriousness, your defense gives you the football twice in plus territory, and you came up with goose eggs. And not only that, but if you miss that field goal, JMU now all of a sudden sets up in great field position. So that was a tremendous lift just provided to this Delaware club. They absolutely needed it.
That was a school record 55 yards from Frank Rago. Congratulations to Frank. 54, the previous log in school history. Trey Sharpin as running back next to Ryan Shore takes the shotgun snap. He's going to throw on the run pass option. It's a screen pass, and clobbered was Ezra Archie, the CAA Rookie of the Week. That'll be a loss of two. Looked like Nigel Hill was there.
My man, Nigel Hill has been impressive since coming into this starting lineup during the Virginia Tech game. And that was perfect. With the shoulder, avoids lowering the head. That was a prime target for getting thrown out of the game for targeting. He avoided it.
Smart freshman. Al Shore going to tuck it. He's going to run, and he runs right into Troy Reeder at the 27-yard line. So third down and long coming up with 8:21. Left in the first quarter, and a 3-0 lead for Delaware.
Boy, the long field goals for Delaware come against great teams. Steve Leo hit a 54-yarder in 1992 against Navy. So kickers saved their best for the best.
You know, big kickers stepping up in big moments here, Matt. That was a heck of a kick by Frank Rago. Now third down and 7. Shores a shotgun form. James Madison 1 of 2 on third down thus far. Looks right, now left. Pressure coming. Bilal chasing him. Shore out of the pocket. Has Jackson to beat. Cuts it up, and he reaches for what I believe should be a first down at the 35. That's a heady play by Brian Shore, who kind of weaved his way for the 7 yards he needed.
That is a fantastic block down the field from Trey Wilson. Wilson realized pretty quickly Shore was going to tuck it and run, and he just knocked Anthony Jackson out of the way.
Brian Shore runs for the first down, and now James Madison quickly for a first down snap. It's Trey Sharp with the football, and he gets into the second unit. Now he's being chased at the 40, to the 30, down the sideline. Being chased by Ray Jones and Troy Reeder at the 10, and caught up inside the red zone. He's going to be marked down at the 6-yard line. Trey Sharp, a 59-yard run, and it's first and goal to go.
Well, that's the problem. JMU spreads out so thin. One guy misses a tackle, there's nobody there to have your back. Great hustle by Jones to chase that play down, save a touchdown. And now, though, the beauty of that tackle by Jones, you're condensed. This defense gets a little easier to defend this side of the field.
Shore out of shotgun and first and goal to go. Back to Sharp, the man that got him there. The next play gets him into the end zone. The Dukes on top, 6-3 after Trey Sharp goes 59 yards and then six to get six on the board for the Dukes.
And that is a frustrating exchange for Delaware to dominate every portion of the game. Two possessions, it was nice to make the 55-yard field goal, but two possessions on JMU's side of the field, you come out of it with 3 points, one big play, now all of a sudden you're losing, and you're losing with wind at your back. JMU doing this into about a 20-mile-per-hour gale.
Tyler Gray will try the extra point. That goes through, so Trey Sharp making the big play happen, 59 yards, and then six to make it 7-3. That's your PNC Bank timeout score with 6:57 remaining in the first.
Hi guys, it's great to be here.
In the desert.
At the mall.
On the mountain.
At school.
At the beach.
In the Big Easy.
Yeah.
Today I want to show you guys the next gen Chevy Equinox. What do you think?
That's pretty.
Pretty sexy.
It's all wheel drive, look at that.
It looks aggressive.
But not overbearing. It's not too big, not too small.
Looks like it could go off-roading.
But at the same time, it looks like a car you could take to a nice event.
You can dress it up or dress it down.
Seems like the perfect car for anybody.
I would take it anywhere.
I want one.
I love it.
She's a bad mamma jamma.
Chevy stepped their game up.
To our last two teams in the 12 teams in 12 day series.
The best part about playing in the CAA.
The best part about playing in the CAA is
by far the competition.
All the competition.
Each week you never know what's gonna happen.
Multiple teams won national championships.
James Madison, kings of the FCS.
We got a lot of great players in this league who can make a play anytime.
When you have to prepare for the CAA teams each and every week, that's what prepares you for playoffs. I think that's what makes it the most dominant conference.
Whether you're a morning person or simply it's not your thing, maybe you're the type that doesn't take it that seriously. Or you're that person who just makes everyone's morning brighter. There's a McDonald's for every morning.
Enjoy a sausage burrito for $1 or a sausage McGriddle sandwich for $2. Pair it with any size freshly brewed McCafe hot coffee for $1.
See that confidence get shaken. That could be a big issue for the Hens. So I like Danny Rocco trying to lift everybody's spirits and trying to make them still feel pretty good about themselves. That being said, you have to respect JMU's ability to hit the big play. You can't miss tackles against this Duke offense.
Gene Coleman back to return what should be a short kick from Tyler Gregan, caught up in the wind. It'll bounce. They've got to grab it at the 18-yard line. And Delaware does so, getting to the 19-yard line, and Corey Spruill had the ball bounce his way as we took it. And Delaware will start with their worst field position of the day. Remember, their first two possessions started at the 41 and 40-yard line in JMU territory. So the first possession where Delaware will start in their own territory at the 19. It's first and 10, 6:51, first quarter.
Just got it. Settle down here a little bit. If you're Joe Walker, I think he's trying to press him. They try to do it just a tad too much. Offensive line, maybe give him another half count longer would certainly help, but there have been some opportunities on these first couple of plays. Just got to stay patient.
Haven't seen Thomas Jefferson yet. Kareem Williams in the game. He remains 3 carries, 7 yards so far. He'll get another carry up the middle across the 20 to the 21. Gus Little is there again to make the stop. So about 2 yards on first down. And again, those second and longs that you wanted to try to avoid.
Well, they're not getting a lot of push up front for the offensive line, but it is a tough group to push. We talked about how consistent they have become up front and how they don't get themselves out of position. There's a little belly read, zone read that time for Walker. It was not the cleanest of exchanges there as Williams had a little bit of a bobble that might have cost him a step as he started towards his left.
Andrew Ankra in on the stop, an all-CAA defensive lineman. Second down and 8, Delaware down 7-3. Two wide receivers on both sides. Empty backfield for Walker. Now Williams in motion. Walker going to keep after he fakes the give, and he didn't fake anybody wearing white. Cornell Urquhart was right there to stop Walker after a pickup of maybe 1. Third down and 7 for the Hens.
Yeah, so far, Delaware has had 3rd-8, 3rd-6, and now 3rd-7. They're 0 for their first two. This, I think, is an important play because, again, you can't stress enough the fact that Delaware is playing with about a 20 to 25 mile per hour sustained wind at their backs in this opening quarter. You don't want to be losing coming out of this first quarter because it's going to get much tougher and, more importantly, much easier for JMU going the other way.
Hens have 5 minutes and 30 seconds left of this wind help. Walker will throw on the run to the outside. Williams catches it but stumbles across the 25-yard line, out of bounds at 26, and it'll be 4th down for Delaware.
Well, the idea there, it's a little out route from Williams. You catch the football, and he can turn upfield. Maybe has a chance to beat the linebacker. It was a blitz from Walker's blind side, so he had to check it down to Williams. The throw just a tad too far out in front. That's why Korean. State the importance of this drive. Delaware is not built to come back from big deficits against a team like this, and especially with the win situation. Got to get a stop.
James Madison will run the football on first down to the 29-yard line. It was Trey Sharp, the guy who leads this game in rushing yards. As Sharp, 3 carries, now 67 yards, as that makes it 2nd down and 7 for James Madison. Shorters the quarterback from the 29-yard line. And again to Sharp, running right this time. A lot of Blue Hens there to stop him as he gets to the 34-yard line. It'll be 3rd down once again for JMU. 4:25 and ticking first quarter as Delaware trails by 4. Sharp, you look at this depth. You talk about Cardon Johnson getting hurt and Marcus Marshall stepping up. Trey Sharp, 3rd on the depth chart to start this season, with a junior can get it done for North Carolina. 193 yards coming into this game, and he'll add to it 68 already. Now 3rd down and 2 for Shore in the James Madison offense. He'll go to Sharp, who spins but is stuffed short. Unless his reach got to the marker, which I don't think it did, he'll be shy at the 36. It was Troy Reeder and Buck Jones who've been very active already in on the stop, so the punt unit coming out for James Madison.
Reeder made the initial hit, Scott, and then Jones came in to clean it up as he tried to spin off. It looked like Sharp might be able to spin free and lunge out, but Jones coming in to finish up the play caused that lunge to finish short. Big stop, big 3 and out from the Delaware defense.
Jamie Jarman back to return this punt, which will come off the leg of Harry O'Kelly. Rugby style, he gets it away towards the JMU sideline, and it gets stuck, takes it. Delaware hop from the 38 to about the 44, where it'll die. That ball just stopped in the air, went backwards, only 21 yards on the punt from O'Kelly. And, you know, we talk about this wind. It is certainly a factor helping on the field goal and helping some field position there for Delaware, as that one actually looked like a lot like the punt that we referenced Eric Henderson kicking against James Madison a few years back.
The thing about the rugby style, when you kick it into the wind like that, sometimes it gets harder to turn it over. You always talk about getting that right type of spin so it bounces and kicks forward, but the wind hurting it, and as a result, as it bounced kind of straight up, I think the wind had as much a factor of that ball bouncing backwards as any type of a metrical thing.
Double tight end set with Whaley and Sharp in the game, Scarf in the game. We see Thomas Jefferson get his first carry. No help, no blocking, and Andrew Ankra eats him up for his 6th tackle for loss on the season. That one going backwards about 5 yards to the 39.
Yeah, we got a chance to talk to Jake Trump this week, and he was very aware of the challenge that his offensive line faced. And one of the things that he talked about, that it was just the little things that had kind of separated the offensive line from a solid start to the season to the type of unit that they want to become. And so far, the little things have not gone Delaware's way.
On second down and 15, a carry to Jefferson, who lost the five, and now he gets about six back to the 45-yard line. Jefferson's first series with the Hens today. 2:25 first quarter, Hens down 7-3.
Funny how that works. We mentioned Jake Trump. He goes and throws a great block. Yeah. He got his guy on the ground that time. And then got a little bit of help from Mario Farinella, who got out and provided a pretty good seal. And that was Delaware's best run of the game. Unfortunately, they went backwards on first down. So they're still stuck in third and long.
Third down and 8, ball on the 46-yard line, Delaware territory. Two wide receivers to the far side left. One near us is Jamie Jarman. Walker rolling, and he throws. It's caught for a first down by Deontay Cherry. A first down and catch number 100 career for Deontay Cherry. Congratulations to the redshirt senior from Lancaster.
Huge play. Nice throw from Walker. He really can't throw a bullet, and he will have the ability to at least throw it when they're going the other direction into the wind, because he throws a pretty tight spiral as it is. And then how about the catch from Deontay Cherry, stumbling near the sideline as he's falling, still able to corral it. Well done by Cherry.
Delaware in James Madison territory for the third time today on four possessions, 1:30 left in the first quarter, and we'll see a flag thrown before the snap.
Prior to snap, ball start, 54, offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, first down.
Brody Kern got a little over-anxious and goosed the football. He knew it right away, too, the frustration as he got up and headed back to the huddle. That's one of those ones we were talking about. The negative plays just get you off schedule. And now, after you finally established a little bit of momentum offensively, and by momentum, I mean you got yourself a first down, which you were in search of, you're back into a first and 15 behind the sticks.
Second time Delaware's had a plus 10 on the down marker. It was second down and 15 earlier in the drive. Walker will throw, completely misses Jamie Jarman at the 45-yard line. Over his head, high and out of reach for Jarman.
They had a blitz coming from the outside. Great job by Thomas Jefferson. They ran that quarter blitz that we saw earlier. Jefferson stepped up and stuck Jimmy Moreland. But I'm not sure Walker was completely comfortable it was going to happen, because he got a little bit of happy feet, and he threw that football without his feet underneath of him, and that's why it sails on him. Just got to get your feet set.
Walker, 2 of 5, 15 yards. As he rolls to the right side on second down and 15, throwing on the run, leaping for it, and getting a foot down before falling out of bounds is Deontay Cherry. What a grab by the senior at the 40.
Looking like a circus performer on that one. He went high, and the upper body reaching out across the side, about 2-3 yards out of bounds to bring that in. And as the foot was up in the air, he forced it down to tap the toe just inside the chalk. Really well done by Deontay Cherry.
Cherry's 101st catch, tying Nick Boyle, who's now a member of the Baltimore Ravens, as Walker will throw. Big third down here, third down and 7. He's going to try to run for it at the 40. First down yards to the 30, cuts it to the 25. Still on his feet as he gets to the 23-yard line. Big run by Joe Walker, moving the sticks after a 17-yard pickup.
Well, that's a really good decision that time by Joe Walker. They were trying to get that ball to Jefferson in the flat on the left side. The linebacker jumped it. Walker was just about to pull the trigger. I think it would have been intercepted. So instead, he tucks it and uses his athleticism. And then a nice job to weave his way through, not just getting the first down and getting down, getting extra yardage on top of it. And boy, did Delaware need a drive here, and they put one together.
Delaware will let the time expire on the first quarter. We'll head to the second quarter of action. Delaware driving 2 yards away from the red zone, down 7-3. That's your PNC Bank timeout score. James Madison on top as we head to quarter number 2 on 94.7 WDSD.
Hi guys, it's great to be here.
In the desert.
At the mall.
On the mountain.
At school.
At the beach.
In the Big Easy.
Yeah.
Today I want to show you guys the next gen Chevy Equinox. What do you think?
That's pretty.
Pretty sexy.
It's all wheel drive, look at that.
It looks aggressive.
But not overbearing. It's not too big, not too small.
It looks like it could go off-roading.
But at the same time, it looks like a car you could take to a nice event.
You can dress it up or dress it down.
Seems like the perfect car for anybody.
I would take it anywhere.
I want one.
I love it.
She's a bad mamma jamma.
Chevy stepped their game up.
I just picked up the cake for the baby shower.
Yay! You know she's having a boy, right?
Oh, boy.
Buick now has an SUV for that. Introducing the new Buick Encore.
I knew I could trust you guys with the cake.
Oh, no problem. That was close.
One of three luxury SUVs from the new Buick.
Get 17% below MSRP on almost every 2017 Encore model. That's over 5,500 on this Buick Encore.
The official bird of Delaware isn't red. It's not green or purple. It's blue. Coincidence? We think not. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware. This blue hen does not need to see a podiatrist. But if he did, waiting for a referral might get his feathers in a bunch. And he wouldn't like that one bit. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware.
First and 10 from the JMU 22-yard line, down 7-3 as Yoakum goes in motion from left to right. Walker gives the football to the running back, Thomas Jefferson, who gets to the 17-yard line. Tackle made by Raven Green, an all-conference senior from Virginia Beach.
A little counter action there from Thomas Jefferson. Starts the flow of the defense to the right and cut it back to the left. Almost was able to sneak his way through Green's grasp. If he does, he probably takes that to the house. But finally, a positive first down play. The Hens have been desperately seeking one of those and got to find a way to get this in. It's been an issue all season long. Hens hoping to have corrected during the bye week.
Second down and 5 for Delaware as the double tight end set for Walker, who sprints to the right side trying to find some blockers. Didn't have any. Got maybe 2 to the 15.
Well, the theory with the quarterback run there, that's a design quarterback sweep. I mean, they're just trying to get the edge and flank JMU is you pick up an extra blocker with Walker ball in his hand. Certainly the quarterback is a non-factor on the running play, but he provides an extra blocker when he keeps it himself. Jefferson trying to get outside and throw a kickout block, but TJ found himself 1-on-3. There wasn't much Thomas Jefferson was going to be able to do to free up Joe Walker.
Pistol formation on 3rd down and 3. Ball on the JMU 15, and Thomas Jefferson tries to lower and dive to the 16. It's going to depend on the spot. They moved the sticks. He got it by inches, Matt.
Yeah, he did a really good job there. We talk about it all the time. He's a big man who runs like a small man. Well, that time he turned himself into a small man and just slivered his way through a small little crevice and dove near the 11-yard line. He got a generous spot, but I think he would have gotten the first down even if they had put it where it looked like he had fallen just inside the 12. They get him all the way to the 11.
Delaware can get a first down without scoring. 1st and 10 from the 11-yard line. Williams into the game. Whaley goes in motion. Walker takes the shotgun snap as Williams looking for some room along the right side. He picks up 1 to 10. A lot of white jerseys there, man.
Here's where the field gets a little bit shorter for Delaware, and you have to deal with the speed of those linebackers when you try to run wide. They're just going to be able to flow to the football. I think you're going to have to hit something cutting against the grain or play action. Now, you wanted to run the ball on first down and get yourself into a favorable down and distance, weren't able to do it. Here's where I would expect a pretty strong possibility. I was going to say play action, but they're just going to go ahead and empty the backfield. So this looks like it's a pass situation. You have to trust Walker to make a good decision.
Yeah, no one in the backfield with Joe Walker on 2nd down and 9, and now some movement again. Delaware might have jumped, pushing him backwards. As the officials talk about it, we'll hear from Tony Marcella.
Prior to the false start, timeout, Delaware.
How about that? There looked like some confusion
first
to start.
Timeout.
And Delaware calls a timeout to make sure there was no confusion, and they get the timeout before any penalty flags were thrown. That'll send us to a timeout. 12:23 remaining in the second quarter. Duke's on top, 7-3. That's your PNC Bank timeout score. Delaware, though, knocking on the door at the 10-yard line.
Whether you're a morning person or simply it's not your thing. Maybe you're the type that doesn't take it that seriously. Or you're that person who just makes everyone's morning brighter. There's a McDonald's for every morning.
Enjoy a sausage burrito for $1 or a sausage McGriddle sandwich for $2. Pair it with any size freshly brewed McCafe hot coffee for $1.
Hi guys, it's great to be here.
In the desert.
At the mall.
On the mountain.
At school.
At the beach.
In the Big Easy.
Yeah.
Today I want to show you guys the next gen Chevy Equinox. What do you think?
That's pretty.
Pretty sexy.
It's all wheel drive, look at that.
It looks aggressive.
But not overbearing.
It's not too big, not too small.
It looks like it could go off-roading.
But at the same time, it looks like a car you could take to a nice event.
You can dress it up or dress it down.
Seems like the perfect car for anybody.
I would take it anywhere.
I want one.
I love it.
She's a bad mamma jamma.
Chevy stepped their game up.
The best part about playing in the CAA.
The best part about playing in the CAA is
by far the competition.
All the competition.
Each week, you never know what's going to happen.
We've had multiple teams win national championships.
James Madison, Kings of the FCS.
We got a lot of great players in this league who can make a play anytime.
When you have to prepare for the CAA teams each and every week, and that's what prepares you for playoffs. I think that's what makes it the most dominant conference.
Kareem Williams in the ball game as the running back. Walker looking to throw. He throws it behind his intended receiver, deflected off a James Madison player, diving for it but unable to catch it was Jamie Jarman. Raven Green, a rare miss on an interception. A first-team All-CAA selection, and that might have been a 95-yard return had he caught it.
I think you get rid of the word might have. He was not going to be caught, and it hit him dead square in the chest. He's going to see that one in his dreams tonight, and that is a very fortuitous break.
But that's Walker again missing his target. He threw it behind Charles Scarf. So third down and 9 from the 10-yard line of James Madison, and flags are thrown. It's going to go against Delaware.
And zone issues continue.
Prior to snap, false start, 54 on the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, third down.
And that's Brody again. That's the captain. That is a 2-time All-CAA selection, and that's the second time Brody has been penalized.
Brody Kern is arguing that they are perhaps communicating there and maybe giving him a little hut action. You know, you used to hear about that. Guys just do that in the NFL all the time. Don't see a center do it twice in the span of about 5 or 6 minutes too often. That's odd.
Brody was having a healthy conversation with the umpire. Now Walker on third down and 14 after the penalty. No one to throw to, but he has time to run around behind the line of scrimmage. Finally into the end zone, he finds Jamie Jarman. A touchdown, and Delaware retakes the lead.
Now, Joe Walker is an interesting guy to watch play this game because his athleticism, you cannot question it. And that was all Joe Walker. He rolled right and started directing traffic, got the entire flow of the JMU defense going that way, stopped on a dime, came back left. Jarman cut off his angle, came back towards that sideline, and then an absolute frozen rope. That's a throw only Joe Walker could make with his arm strength. And he put it on the money.
A 15-yard touchdown for Jamie Jarman on third and 14 for the Hens. Frank Rago knocks it through. And with 12:07 remaining in the second quarter, Delaware back on top. Your PNC Bank timeout score, Delaware 10, James Madison 7.
International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, Local 313.
The official bird of Delaware isn't red. It's not green or purple. It's blue. Coincidence? We think not. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield, Delaware. This blue hen does not need to see a podiatrist. But if he did, waiting for a referral might get his feathers in a bunch. And he wouldn't like that one bit. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield, Delaware.
Hi guys, it's great to be here.
In the desert.
At the mall.
On the mountain.
At school.
At the beach.
In the Big Easy.
Yeah.
Today I want to show you guys the next gen Chevy Equinox. What do you think?
That's pretty.
Pretty sexy.
It's all wheel drive, look at that.
It looks aggressive.
But not overbearing.
It's not too big, not too small.
Looks like it could go off-roading.
But at the same time, it looks like a car you could take to a nice event.
You can dress it up or dress it down.
Seems like the perfect car for anybody.
I would take it anywhere.
I want one.
I love it.
She's a bad mamma jamma.
Chevy stepped their game up.
Rush hour or relax hour. It's your choice. Ride more, save more, do more. Dart, moving forward.
The best part about playing in the CAA.
The best part about playing in the CAA is
by far the competition.
All the competition. Each week, you never know what's going to happen.
We've had multiple teams win national championships.
James Madison, Kings of the FCS.
We got a lot of great players in this league who can make a play anytime.
When you have to prepare for the CAA teams each and every week, and that's what prepares you for playoffs. And I think that's what makes it the most dominant conference.
Hard time making that play. He could have done the running around part, but the arm strength to deliver that football across his body, that's a 30-yard lateral throw on top of the 20 yards he had to get it from where he released it to in the end zone, and to do it as a frozen rope, not allowing the defense to have time to come back over and recover. That's the upside that the coaching staff always talks about with Joe Walker, the plays that he has the capability of making. It's can you get him to the point where he can do it consistently? The consistency has been creeping up, not quite at the speed that you hoped for, but boy, if he can get there, the talent, I mean, that play is Joe Walker in a nutshell. The ability to escape contain, reverse his field, and throw a frozen rope. Those are all his talents, his potential on full display.
First kick into the wind from Rolfe, and it's returnable. Marshall gets it at the 16 to the 15-yard line, gets past Colby Reeder at the 25. He spins off of a Delaware defender to the 30. We'll mark it at the 30-yard line as Poindexter made the stop. There's a guy slow to get up. I believe it's Tenny Adewusi. And he's back at the 15-yard line where the catch was made by Marcus Marshall. That brings us to a Newark urgent care injury stoppage as he'll get looked at. And Delaware already without Justin Watson for the season in that secondary. Tenny Adewusi, a very important part. And now it looks like he's being worked on.
Looks like left leg is what they were looking at right away as he went down.
Coach Rocco on the field as well.
He had that elevated, so hopefully it's not anything serious. But you're right, that's a position where Delaware just cannot afford to lose any more bodies in there already as it is.
Coach Rocco talking about depth issues this week, and we heard Dr. Axon, the pregame show, mentioned Steve Robinson going to be able to play today on the offensive line. So them getting some additional depth, and the secondary is certainly a position where when Watson goes out, you had to move some things around. Even Riley Angeline, an offensive player, moved to linebacker this week. And it's Casey Hinton that was down. Still, Casey Hinton, a big part of this special teams and a defensive back himself, is the one unable to get up. And you can thank Adidas for the error on the number there.
They've got bigger problems this week.
That's very true. Fixing our jerseys is not highly ranked at the Adidas
headquarters.
Good
news is, though, Hinton.
Yeah, he's walking off on
walking, but he's walking off under his own power. And I do like what Delaware did there. You know, the kick was short because of the wind, but he put it high up in the air. And Roth has a strong enough leg. He was able to get it to the 10. That allowed the coverage unit to get down the field and pretty good coverage.
JMU starts at their own 30 with trips to the right side. And Marcus Marshall, the running back, play action, sure going down the field, looking for Alls, and he overthrows his target. That's Terrence Alls, who was defended closely by Malcolm Brown. Alls has not played in the first 4 weeks, a transfer from Duke. He had 38 catches over his career, 8 of them coming as a member of the ACC.
Now that's a big part of JMU's offense. Corey talks about it in the pregame show. They like to take shots and throw up 50-50 balls, but the wind is going to make that really tough today. That ball floated to the sideline because of the gusts.
Same look for James Madison with trips. In motion goes Nick Carlton, the tight end. Shotgun snap. And now into the chest of Marshall, who starts right, tries to go left, slowed up by Colby Reeder. Troy finishes the play at the 33-yard line. Charles Bell in there as well. 11:42 and ticking second quarter, and it'll be third down for James Madison, down by three.
You know, he didn't make the tackle, but that is a freak of nature play. That was a left tackle. Colby Reeder shedding the block up, and then he was still able to keep contained and almost make the stop. Fantastic effort.
Delaware Stadium making some noise on third down and 7 for James Madison. Shore talking to his center, Mac Patrick, as he awaits the snap. Now turns, speaks to the running back, Marcus Marshall. Shore needs 7 from his own 33. Takes the snap, being pressured, sees some room to run. Tucks, gets the first down. He's tackled by Anthony Jackson and Charles Bell, but not before he gets yardage out to the 44, and it looks like Bell is slow to get up.
He is in some real discomfort down there.
Shore kind of jumped into him.
And lowered his shoulder, too, last second.
I wonder if the knee didn't get into somewhere where Charles Bell was grabbing Shore, because he kind of jumped right into Charles.
Well, it was a really good job by Marshall there. He had set up a little stop route near the first down marker. And again, they have a really good feel for when Shore is going to tuck and tuck the ball and run, but he keeps his eyes downfield. The defense has to play him honest, but they turn themselves into blockers and get some movement, and they were able to really avoid Bell getting himself in a good position to make the stop short of the first down. Charles, to his credit, was able to adjust, and I just think he took a real big pop there from Shore. It's a straight run up the middle. He's got a center in front of him. And yeah, it looked like maybe either a shoulder or a knee. Couldn't tell which one it was. Right up in the chin or jaw type area there on Charles Bell as we caught a second look at it. And that did not seem pleasant. And it's certainly something that you hope he's all right.
Great training staff of Delaware out onto the field for another Newark urgent care injury stoppage. And Dan Watson is 13th season here. Brandon DeSantis, Dr. Andrew Reisman is 11th year with Delaware. We have to call their names, but they're out on the field, and Delaware has top-notch guys in those positions to take care of the Delaware players. 11:03 remaining in the second quarter. Delaware up 10-7 on James Madison. That's our score. Let's take a look around the CAA.
Well, Elon and Albany are playing a close game. I'm not sure how much fun it is to watch. Elon getting into the top 25 this season for the first time since they've joined the CAA with their win last week. Looked like they're going to get another win here. They're on top of Albany 6-0. 1 minute 46 seconds to go in the fourth quarter. So not much offense there, but Elon could play some defense. It was a big game. Albany coming off a huge win as well. They had just beaten Villanova. The Phoenix with the football final, minute 46, and they have it in Albany territory, so trying to put the finishing touches on a victory. Meanwhile, later in the CAA, New Hampshire will host Bryant. That game is at 6 p.m. in conference. William & Mary hosting Stony Brook, also a 6 o'clock kickoff. Villanova trying to bounce back from that loss. All of a sudden, the Wildcats in some trouble. Two early losses to Temple and now Albany. They are in a must-win game. They're at Towson at 6 p.m. as Charles Bell is up and on his feet with help from that athletic training staff. And one other game later at 7 p.m., the Battle of Rhode Island. The Rams taking on Brown, and Rhode Island 1-3 on the year, but have been competitive in 3 of their first 4 games.
Charles Bell, thank you, Matt, for those scores, and we'll have more updates on around the CAA throughout the game. Charles Bell is being helped by both trainers off of the field. It looked to me, as we watched a couple of replays, a knee to maybe the head or underneath where that helmet was by Shore as he jumped into Charles Bell. He's being helped off the field.
Yeah, that doesn't look like a guy we're going to see back in the game, unfortunately, anymore. Hopefully Charles Bell is all right. It's certainly a big loss for Delaware, but in a situation like that, you just worry more for the kid than for what's going to go out of the field.
Back in action on first down and 10 after the first down pickup by Brian Shore. Marshall trying to find some room to run. He slips as he reversed course, and it'll be a loss of about 3 for Marshall as Jalen Kindle came in for Bell and was there to make it difficult for Marshall.
You know, Charles Bell's a special player, and he will certainly be missed, but Jalen Kendall is a capable kid, and he is certainly an athletic guy who will run around and make some plays.
Second down and 12 for sure. Ball at the 42. He tosses to his tight end at the 47-yard line. It'll be third down and long for James Madison. Riley Stapleton from Indiana gets his 13th catch of the season. You know, talking about Jalen Kendall, he was a starter, 11 games as a sophomore, and then last year with Reeder coming in, kind of lost his spot in that starting lineup, but he's made some good plays this year, a pass breakup and 8 tackles now on the year. Third down and 6 for James Madison, they'll call it, from the 48 in their own territory. Down by 3, short with some time, now pocket closing, good blocking, now being chased by 3 Blue Hens. He throws it into Delaware territory, sliding to make the catch is Nick Carlton at the 48 of Delaware, shy of the first down marker, but there was a flag.
On the offense, it's a 10-yard penalty, third down.
And that was holding against James Madison. That's all that JMU could do as Delaware was starting to put the pressure on short.
A little surprised Danny Rocco is taking the penalty here, 4th and 2. I would think JMU would go for it, but he likes the chances at 3rd and 16. It's always the type of offense you get worried about giving them 2 shots. Now 3rd and 16 against this defense you would think is a low percentage chance. But a lot of coaches would have taken the result and either hope for a JMU punt or trusted their defense to get off the field. Rocco trying to play the field position slash down and distance game.
See what James Madison can do on 3rd down and 16 back at their own 38-yard line after the penalty. As Shore awaits the snap, he has it. Has some time. Now being pressure. Here comes Woodson. Shore has to roll. Running out of time. Woodson misses. Now Shore reverses. He cuts it. Still behind the line of scrimmage. He can throw if he wants to. A pump fake. He gets the line of scrimmage. On the run. At the 50. Hit at midfield and down he goes. 4 yards shy of the first down marker after all that running by Brian Short.
It's a great job by the Delaware secondary, though, on the scramble drill. Don't lose your man. Don't lose your assignment. Don't lose your portion of the zone. And Delaware stayed disciplined defensively. Short was looking to throw the football as he broke contain off that last cut, but everybody was accounted for.
Now James Madison will punt the football on 4th down and 4 from midfield. This time the wind at their backs, and this punt will roll, bouncing from the 12 and down at the 2-yard line. That's a 48-yard punt by Harry O'Kelly. I'm wondering why Jamie Jarman was anywhere near that football, but luckily for Delaware, nothing bad happened as far as him touching the football and then James Madison doing the same.
Well, I think he was trying to deke. He knew he was going to get out of the way. He almost got blocked into the ball. But if you get blocked into the ball, you're fine. That's not a fumble. You're not allowed to drive a guy into the football. Jamie, you tried it. Not a bad idea. You never know what will happen. Maybe an official will make a mistake. But, you know, I think he was trying to deke and then bail last second and kind of paid for it as he got popped over there.
Hey, got some pretty exciting news for our friends at Brandywine Electronics. And I don't know if you knew this, but President Obama made a surprise visit to Wilmington on Monday. And Joe and Brandywine Electronics were asked to produce the event and provide audio, video, and lighting and staging for this very exciting event. What an honor for Brandywine Electronics to be asked to be at that event on Wednesday. The Secret Service asked Joe to help them out with a homeland security matter even. And
the official bird of Delaware isn't red. It's not green or purple. It's blue. Coincidence? We think not. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware. This blue hen does not need to see a podiatrist. But if he did, waiting for a referral might get his feathers in a bunch. And he wouldn't like that one bit. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware.
Hi guys, it's great to be here.
In the desert.
At the mall.
On the mountain.
At school.
At the beach.
In the Big Easy.
Yeah.
Today I want to show you guys the next gen Chevy Equinox. What do you think?
That's pretty.
Pretty sexy.
It's all wheel drive, look at that.
It looks aggressive.
But not overbearing.
It's not too big, not too small.
Looks like it could go off-roading.
But at the same time, it looks like a car you could take to a nice event.
You can dress it up or dress it down.
Seems like the perfect car for anybody.
I would take it anywhere.
I want one.
I love it.
She's a bad mamma jamma.
Chevy stepped their game up.
own 2-yard line, and Kenai Kane, who's in the game for the first time, gets a carry and gives Delaware some wiggle room out to the 8. 6-yard pickup.
Now the Hens right now have got to find a way to flip the field. You know, if you can score on this drive, a 98-yard march, that'd be great. But with the wind howling the way it is, you're not going to be able to get off. Very good punt. You've got to string together a couple of first downs here. Successful first down play certainly helps that.
I form for Delaware. The give is to Kane again, and this could be a big one. At the 25, 30, 35, and down he goes at the 45-yard line. Kenai Kane, a 37-yard run. Brandon Hereford and Curtis Oliver finally brought him down.
Well, Kenai Kane's the guy that goes in the game when they go to that bigger package. He's your goal line back, but try to show the coaching staff, hey, guys, I can run more than 1 or 2 yards. I've got this. Showed some speed there as he got to the second level. A nice little cut to his left. That's a heck of a run.
Delaware trying to add to what is a 10-7 lead, 7:35, second quarter. Now they've got the football on their own 45. This drive started 3 plays ago at the 2-yard line. Deontay Cherry with 2 catches goes in motion. They'll feed Kareem Williams. A flag is thrown as he picks up 11, maybe 12 yards to the 43 after Jordan Brown made the stop.
Yeah, I think that's going to be a hold, though, on Delaware is the reason why that hole opened up in the middle.
That could have been a face mask as well.
Personal foul, chop block. Offense, number 54 and 67. It's a 15-yard penalty. First down.
I thought it was Brody Kern. I thought they were going to call him for the hook. He hooked, but he also hooked as his teammate tried to go low and cut Connor Lutz. And that's one of those ones that's tough because if you engage even the slightest, basically if you know you push a guy on the left shoulder pad while somebody else is setting up a cut block, that wasn't one of those ones where Delaware was trying to do anything dirty. It was just a little bit of miscommunication up front. The tough day continues for poor Brody Kern.
That's the third penalty on Brody Kern. Wow, does that take back some of the momentum that Delaware had? It was first and 10 from the 45, now first and 25. A screen pass is behind Kareem Williams. Drop, they'll say it was a backwards pass picked up by Ankra, and he'll walk it into the end zone. James Madison scores a touchdown on a dropped backwards pass by Kareem Williams, scooped and scored by Andrew Ankra. I was waiting for that play to be blown dead because I thought that was a screen.
That'll be reviewed.
They've got to take a look at that.
I mean, it's close. It might have been backwards. To the naked eye, I thought it was slightly forward. Hopefully they had the angle.
Pass. Recovered by James Madison. Returned for a touchdown. The penalty is under review.
The problem is if it's close, the ruling on the field was that it was a backwards pass, so it'll have to be indisputable.
Well, let's see. As he drops back, he releases it. That's four.
Yeah,
I think that's a half-yard forward. Now, it's behind Kareem Williams. He's standing a yard in front of where Walker releases the football. If it's dead lateral, that's not forward. But, boy, that seemed like it was a half-yard back to me. A half-yard forward to me. It's so close.
It's close.
It might not be.
It's
it might
close.
Not be.
We're watching it here at Delaware Stadium, a couple of replays, and it might be close enough not to be overturned. You're right, Matt. It's close. That's another one of those passes where you just have to make the pass.
And it's, again, the footwork. He didn't get his feet underneath of him, kind of trying to get rid of it in a hurry, look the defense off. But as he throws it through his shoulders with his feet not underneath of him, it pulls the throw back behind Kareem and evidently behind where he released it, which is the worst-case scenario.
They're looking at this thing. I thought from the naked eye, full speed, that it was a screen pass and perhaps a forward one.
I still think it was a forward pass. I just don't think when you look at the replay, you're going to be able to say definitively it was forward. I mean, to me, it looks like he releases it at the 22 and it goes to the 22 and a half.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. Touchdown, James Madison.
And that's an important distinction. It didn't get confirmed, but there wasn't enough evidence to overturn. You didn't have that definitive down-the-line view, and that's a devastating turn of events for Delaware.
You get a 37-yard run by Kenai Kane, a 15-yard penalty after that, and then a fumble recovered by Andrew Ankro, and all of a sudden, your 10-7 lead becomes possibly 14-10. James Madison, here comes the extra point. Tyler Gray puts it up and into the student section, and that is a can't let it be deflated. I'm up here a little deflated, but I think those guys are better than that down on the sideline. So 6:53, if you're the coaching staff, you're telling your team, we get the football right back, and let's get going. Let's take a lead into the locker room. Let's score here, 6:53. But that's certainly the Kenai Kane run gave Delaware a chance to put together potentially a 98-yard drive, and then you go backwards, and then you turn over. That's tough.
But again, it's little things that are killing Delaware right now. You've got the number one team in the nation, defending national champions, in your house. You've got to clean up these small mistakes. Now, that was a big mistake, obviously, the backwards pass. You can't have stuff like that happening. It goes without saying. But the chop block penalty, it's just a little bit of miscommunication from your offensive line. One guy engages high. As he disengages, somebody cuts. But that's a 15-yard penalty. Puts you behind the sticks. Now, all of a sudden, you're trying to throw. And as you throw under a little bit of pressure, Joe Walker makes a very inaccurate toss. And it results in 7 the other way.
Gene Coleman back to return for the second time today. This one might be returnable. He continues to fade backwards into the end zone, though, as the wind helped that one hang in the air a little bit longer. So a touchback for Delaware. They'll have the football back after the fumble recovery by Andrew Ankra. And James Madison back on top, 14-10, 6:53 remaining second quarter.
Keep this in mind, though, Scott. Delaware deferred to start the game, so they will get the football to start the second half. So you have an opportunity to go the old two-for-one here if you can put together one of those time-consuming drives and execute here, get yourself some points. Granted, 3 might be tough into this gale force wind, but if you can find a way to score and bleed clock, you will get the football to start the second half, and you can rip momentum back in your favor, and more importantly, control of the game back in your direction.
Kane remains in the game, 43 yards rushing on 2 carries for Kenai, and now Walker on the fake give to Kane, gets to the outside in the 31-yard line, a pickup of 6 on first down. Tackle made by Kyrie Hawkins, Jimmy Moreland in there as well.
Really good job by Walker. That was a great decision because I thought Gus Little over-pursued the football, and that opening on the outside was there. Walker has the speed to get to the edge. And there's that positive play on first down. All of a sudden starting to crop up after they were non-existent in the opening quarter. Delaware's been much better on first down in this second period.
Walker in shotgun on second down and 4. Yoakum to his right, running back to his left, and Walker will run again. He slips a tackler to the 40, stays in bounds around the 44. He gets crushed by Bryce McGinley on his way out of bounds, but 2 runs by Joe Walker, and Delaware picks up the first. That was a 14-yard carry by the quarterback.
And he ran right through Gus Little again. That was not the best set of downs there from Gus Little. That's quarterback power all the way. Lead blocker in front of Joe Walker. And then he makes a guy miss on his own. And that is some of what Walker can bring to the table for you. Get you an extra blocker.
Walker up to 31 yards rushing. First and 10 at the 44. To the running back this time it goes. Right side to the 47-yard line. And 5:46 and ticking in the first half. It was Kenai Kane, his 4th carry of the day.
Not a ton of success between the tackles outside of that long burst from Kane, but I do like the way Kane runs, man. Low to the ground with some power, but a burst of quickness I think defenders aren't expecting.
Lots to like about the junior from Bridgeville, Delaware, and they'll call his number again. He got tripped up. I think he hit the foot of Connor Lutz as he was cutting to the left side. There was some space on that left side if he would have get there, but instead, falling at the Delaware 49, it's 3rd down and 5.
Yeah, you're right. I thought he tripped over the eye on UD, the big UD insignia at midfield, but you're right, Lutz, as he was backpedaling, and as Kane was trying to set to cut his feet to the left, they collided, and he just splattered towards the ground. Nice job to lunge forward, though, and at least get a little something.
3rd down and 5 for Delaware. They're down 14-10, under 5 minutes, first half, and Walker going to tuck, going to sprint, and he's reaching for it. Fouls finally at the 45-yard line. He went to the ground on the back of a JMU player before his knee touched the ground. He reached while on top of Darius Carter for the first down pickup. Heady play by the quarterback.
He not only reached, he rolled. He was able to just kind of use him and just spin his way on top of poor Darius Carter. And then I think he got kicked forward as well by Simeon Robinson. That was a heck of an effort by Walker.
On first down for Delaware, Kane is the running back. Kane with the carry, looking for space as he goes to the left side at the 45 and powers his way to the 40 and down at the 39. He is a hard man to bring down. Gus Little did it as well, or alongside of Andrew Ankrum.
He got hit, and I thought stymied at the 42. And then he pushed his way to near the 40, and then he just moved the pile forward another yard. And JMU going to take a timeout. I think they are frustrated with the tackling from their defense right now. And Delaware can sense it. They are fired up on the sideline. A whole team huddle.
Delaware fired up. Everyone off the sideline except our man Corey Nido. He's down there. The energy seems to be pretty high down there, Corey.
It really is. And with the injury to Charles Bell and that backwards pass, you think maybe this Blue Hens team might be deflated. It's the complete opposite. Matt mentioned the entire team huddling out on the field. And for JMU, a lot of arm tackles. And you're not going to bring down Kenai Kane with arm tackles. He is a big man. And right now, Kane is giving some life and energy to this offense with his physicality.
And I tell you what, I really like the job this coaching staff has done. I think they've called a good game, but almost as important, they've been like psychologists over there on the sideline trying to keep Delaware's spirits buoyed despite some tough adversity they have faced in the early going, and it's paid off. This team has played with a very high emotional pitch throughout this first half.
Offset eye is Williams. Now the running back on second and four. Play action. Walker will lob it to Yoakum, intercepted by Raven Green. He tiptoes the sideline, stays in. Interception was made. Raven Green all over it, his second interception of the season.
Kasasa. What's Kasasa? It's a catchy word for earning cash that just might make you want to dance.
Over there by Delaware.
And it's spot now, if you're the Hens, though, the defense has good field position, maybe a three and out, and you can still get points.
Trey Sharp is the running back. He'll get the carry on the left side. Down he goes at the 8 yard line.
What they called, I think you missed it, was an illegal block in the back and a personal foul for a hit on a defenseless player. And so what that essentially did was they enforced both penalties. 10 from the spot of the foul, then half the distance, so that's why you're backed up all the way near the 5. Unfortunately, the interception from Walker just didn't look off the safety and floated one up the sideline that he was able to go over and get.
Second down and 8 for James Madison. Fumble. And Shore dropped the football, picked it back up. Tackled by Anthony Jackson for a loss. A potential break for Delaware, but a heady play by Brian Shore.
What a bounce for Brian Shore. That ball popped right back into his chest. You almost never see that when a quarterback mishandles on a handoff. Just went right at his feet and then hopped up to about knee high. And it's a shame, too, because the Hens had two guys bearing down on him in position to recover. Had it bounced away even a little.
Third down and 7. 2:45 and ticking, second quarter. Brian Shore to Trey Sharp. Running to the left side. Bilal Nickel gets there first, but he slips past him. Ray Jones in on the stop, but I think he got the first down out to the 16-yard line. That's a nice job by Trey Sharp, eluding Bilal Nichols. and getting past Ray Jones enough to move the stick.
Just guys you don't see miss tackles very often. I mean, this year Adderley had a shot at him as well. Those are three very sure tacklers and just couldn't find a way to get him to the ground, which we talked about how important it would be for Delaware.
First and 10 after the carry by Sharp at the 17-yard line for James Madison. Two running backs, and Sharp's going to throw quickly to Sharp at the 20-yard line. He's wrapped up there, but a pickup of about four on first down.
I think we talked about this a couple of weeks ago, but it's worth saying again. You want to make football a safer game, get the officials to start blowing whistles when guys are being held up. Guys rally to the football, and they fly around, and they're trying to finish plays off because officials are just so late blowing the whistle. You had another late shot there.
Sure. Give to the running back. It's Sharp bouncing around a little. Reeder grabs him, and as just Anthony Jackson, and maybe what you were just talking about right there is it allowed the later whistle, allowed two or three other Blue Hen players to drag down Sharp.
It's just extra hits and contact you don't need, and it also makes guys mad, and it leads to some chippiness perhaps down the line. I like not calling timeout here, by the way, because you want to see if you can get a stop. You get the stop, then you try to take the timeout, but you don't want to give JMU any more time than they need to have.
Third down and three for JMU. It'll be Sharp. And Delaware was just as fooled as I was as he got out to the 34-yard line on that option play. They gave it to the running back, and they pick up the first down.
Yeah, Bilal Nichols got cut that time. And just a little bit of a sliver of space up the middle, JMU took advantage.
Under a minute to play in this first half. James Madison up 14-10. With the ball at the 34-yard line. Sure going to throw. It was tipped but caught by James Madison in Delaware territory at the 40. It was Ishmael Hyman with the catch. A 27-yard pickup. A Delaware player got their hand on the football, but Hyman was able to find it and catch the football. Get a couple extra yards into Delaware territory. Big pickup, longest of the day for Brian Shore. In fact, he only had 10 yards passing prior to that completion. Shore had a shotgun on first and 10. He wants to throw down the field for the same target. Hyman bobbles it, and it falls incomplete at the one-yard line. Excellent coverage that time by Tenny Adewusi.
Adewusi, a little trail technique. He had a step, perfect throw from Shore. It had to be a perfect throw. But I'll tell you, he made it. That ball's got to be caught. That would have been a touchdown there for JMU then, dodging a bullet. But nice job by Adewusi to stay with the play. So when the bobble occurred, he was close enough to get involved.
I'm in the transfer from Kansas. A senior trips to the right side on second down and 10 now. The Delaware 39-yard line. Short with pressure coming. Screen pass is caught at the 40. 45 and down. Colby Reeder on the tackle. Trey Sharp making it third down and manageable with 17 seconds left in the half, and JMU will call their final timeout.
Well, you just can't get Colby Reeder blocked. That is the second time we have seen in this game left tackle Aaron Stinney get out there on a screen. All he's got to do is block Colby Reeder, and that's a 20-25 yard play. And Reeder just sheds him and forces the play back inside to his pursuit. It's a heck of an effort by Reeder. And without a timeout now, JMU's in a pickle. They have got to make sure they get this either to the sideline or to a first down. It's third and five, so you would think they would be able to get it to the sticks, but if they get tackled middle of the field, you can't clock the ball because it would be fourth down. That's it. It's pretty much going to be the end of the half.
Career long of Tyler Gray, their kicker, is 45 against North Dakota State.
I feel like this is a 10-yard win, though.
Yeah, you'd get a little extra, as we saw from Frank Rago. So keep that in mind. It's third down and five, 17 seconds left. James Madison up by four. It's 14-10. And Brian Shore about to snap the football for the 10th time on this drive. In motion goes the Virginia transfer, David Eldridge. Shore steps into a throw, has his man at the 26. It's a first down, so the clock will stop momentarily as Alls gets
flag.
It. There is a flag. It comes in late.
That hurts. It's holding on the hens, but more important, just stops the clock.
Right. 12 seconds. Five came off. Officiating crew we'll hear from in a moment.
Holding in a college game is 10 yards, so he'll take the penalty.
The referee with his hands to the sky asking, whoever blew the whistle what the penalty. They're going backwards. Nope, now they're going forwards. I don't think the officials know exactly what's going on.
He needs the referee.
There we go. Hold on.
Hold on. The official said hold on.
Nobody told the referee what the penalty was.
Defense number one. It's a 10-yard penalty.
Ryan Shore is under center as the referee is speaking right now.
What do they do? They look like they want to clock the ball, but the clock is stopped. What was that?
Nothing came off the clock when he spiked it.
It didn't matter.
The clock was stopped. You didn't need to.
It didn't matter because you're not going to be able to run multiple plays anyway. But it,
a lot
it
of things going wrong on that exchange from the
KMU,
officials to the clock operator to Brian Shore. But here we go.
But it's a good point from Danny Rocco. They spiked the ball. Time has to go off the clock. You can't have a 0-second play.
It was at 12. It remains at 12 on second down and 10 from the Delaware 23-yard line with Shore out of shotgun. He pumps. Looking to throw, sideline, throws it high and out of bounds with 6 seconds left. So now you have to decide if you're James Madison, do you kick a field goal or do you try for the end zone? It looks like they're going to, with the wind's help, send Tyler Gray out.
I mean, it's a 40-yarder. That's within his range as it is. And with the wind in his back, he should have plenty of leg. Just kidding. Sticking between the goalposts. You didn't want to give up points here. You certainly feel like you've left some opportunities out there, but you can live with three.
Rocco had a timeout, has two actually, so he wanted to ice the kicker. So he calls a timeout. Don't forget, before Coach Rocco gets into the locker room, we'll hear from Corey Nido. He'll have thoughts from Coach Rocco on the first half of football. That interview presented by Rufo Associates. Visit RufoLaw.com. So Delaware hanging in there with James Madison, the number one ranked team in the country, the defending national champions, and certainly some mistakes for Delaware, and the last one, which gave James Madison a touchdown on a fumbled backwards pass.
I mean, they
held Delaware's
JMU
winning this game without that.
They've held JMU to 7 points.
Yeah.
They gave JMU 7 points is the problem, and then they have failed to execute as they've gotten in plus territory. That has been the killer. I mean, you start two drives in plus territory, you get 3 points. You march into plus territory on a third occasion, you turn the football over, and then you give a touchdown to JMU. All those things added up, you feel like you're fortunate to be down by just 4 or 7, depending on how this field goal turns out.
Hunter Etheridge will hold. Tyler Gray will get the kick off, has the distance, and Tyler Gray's field goal is good from 40 yards. It'll leave a second on the first half clock. There's that second left over from when they didn't run one off on the clock. So James Madison will likely take a 17-10 lead into the locker room after that field goal, which they'll officially call 39 from Tyler Gray.
Yeah, talk to the clock operator here at Delaware Stadium. You don't have to be quite so twitchy-fingered on those last second
right,
field goals.
No one would mind if he let that 1 second run off, but because they kept a second on the clock, we'll see a kickoff.
But just secure the football if you're Delaware here. I mean,
this one.
Yeah, you're going to kick the ball to the ground if you're JMU. The only thing that could happen is either return it for a touchdown or you fumble it and JMU returns it for a touchdown. Both are low percentage chances, but don't take the risk. Don't try to be a hero and break a bunch of tackles. Just make sure you're first and foremost securing it. It might even be a spot where Danny Rocco tells his guy to catch it, take it.
Kane and Spruill are the up men at the 15-yard line. Gene Coleman is all the way back. James Madison will try to keep this one in play just so they can get a shot at ripping the ball loose or something wacky happening. Tyler Gray going to kick this one off after making a 39-yard field goal to put the James Madison Dukes up by 7. A squib bounces to Spruill at the 15, to the 20, at the 25, 30, and get down Corey Spruill. He does so at the 31. No whistle, though. He's still spinning. That was more dangerous than it needed to be. Down he goes at the 32, and that officially brings us to the half. Some mistakes by the Blue Hens cost them what could have been a halftime lead over James Madison. Instead, JMU leads 17-10 as we head into the locker room. And in just a moment, Corey Nido will be with head coach Danny Rocco. This interview once again presented by Rufo Associates. Visit RufoLaw.com. And Coach Rocco approaching Corey Nido now. Will send it down to Corey in or near the locker room.
All right, thank you, Scott. Coach, you hold JMU to a field goal right before the half. Overall, your team seems like they haven't lost any confidence with a couple of turnovers, Bell's injury. Overall, what have you seen from your team in the first half?
Well, we've had some opportunities and taken advantage of, which really could have given us a lead here and going to the locker room at halftime. But it's a very competitive game. I think we got a great shot coming out here in the second half and winning the game. We're going to need a spark offensively, right, to get a big chunk of yards and maybe get a quick score. But really put ourselves in position here going into the locker room. We'll just have to clean some things up, come out here and try to get some quick momentum in the second half.
Coach, thanks for your time.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you, Corey. Thank you to Coach Rocco as well. That brings us to the Blue Hens Halftime Report presented by the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, Local 313, and its local contractors. Benny Pinella is back in the WDSD studios. He'll have scores from out of town and around the world of college sports in a moment. At the half, James Madison 17, Delaware 10 from Delaware.
Senior offensive lineman at the University of Delaware. So I got into football because my older brother was playing peewees at the time. I was about 5 or 6 years old, and they used to make me come out there and be the water boy. But the problem was, when I was the water boy, I had to go through all the conditioning and all that stuff. So then I actually started playing when I was 8, when I was old enough, and I've been playing ever since. I chose Delaware because as soon as I came, I fell in love with the campus immediately, and all the history and stuff like that that comes with Delaware football, I wanted to be a part of. But I was like, if I ever get an offer, I said, this is where I want to be. Got that offer actually on my, I think, 18th birthday. We haven't had seasons like we wanted to, and this being my last year, I think the sky's the limit with this team, the amount of experience and stuff like that that we have. Coach Rocco coming in and like all of his staff has been a huge change, just to their track record of how successful they've been both at Richmond and Liberty was very impressive and made us excited. Being a 4-7 team, nobody remembers that. Nobody cares about that. So right now, being their last year, I think guys are realizing that they want to be remembered for something, and we're developing more leaders and just more excitement around the program.
Senior linebacker, Delaware. I was about 8 years old, and my dad, we went and signed up, and ever since then I just fell in love with it and been playing ever since. I was always a running back and linebacker, and I like to tackle people, so they just put me linebacker. I chose Delaware because of the tradition. You know, I went there on a few visits, and every time I went, it felt like a family atmosphere, and I really liked that. I mean, everyone knows about Coach Rocco from Richmond. I think him and his coaching staff are going to do a great job this year. They're all very proven coaches. And I think all of our players have bought into their system as a whole, and we're going to hopefully keep building throughout from spring, summer, and the camp. I'm sure they'll have a little chip on their shoulder, but it'll be a good game. I mean, statistically, we haven't been the best team in the conference, but for me personally, it's been a great experience. I've had a lot of fun and met a lot of great people, and I'm ready to go for my senior year. This year, our goal is to win the CAA and make the playoffs. The best part about playing the CAA is all the competition. And I think it's a dominant conference because of all the great coaches and all the players just work really hard, and just turns out to be great games every week.
Touchdown. Ishmael Hyman has one catch for 27 yards for James Madison, leading the yardage category for the Dukes. Trey Sharp has two catches for 6 yards. Tackle-wise, Troy Reeder leads Delaware with 8. Charles Bell, 5 tackles. That was before it looked like a pretty bad back injury. He was wheeled off into the locker room, and he's not going to come back today. That's Newark Urgent Care injury update for you. We wish the best on Charles Bell, not only for today, but for the rest of the season. And as soon as we know anything about Charles Bell, we'll try to update you more than that. Brandon Herford of James Madison missed the first 4 games of the season, but he likes playing against Delaware. 8 tackles in his first 2 games against the Hens. He's got 5 to lead the team in this one. Of course, Andrew Ankra, an all-CAA performer for James Madison. He's the one that went scoop and score on the backwards pass that wasn't a backwards pass, but was called as such for a touchdown.
You know, that was the talk in the rest of the press box during halftime. Pretty much everybody agreeing that it sure looked like it was forward, but it was hard to say definitively enough to overturn it. That was pretty much the consensus out there, and it's kind of what we looked at as well. You know, certainly we're in Delaware, so there's a little bit more of a tilt towards the Blue Hens, but even the JMU radio folks who got a peek of it on the TV screens nearest thought the exact same thing. So one of those tough breaks for Delaware, but also one of those plays where it shouldn't have been executed where it looked that close. It was a bad throw by Joe. He'd be the first one to tell you that. It's the kind of things you have to find a way to clean up in the second half if you're UD. I think Danny Rocco alluded to it going into the locker room. Delaware played a pretty solid first half. It just wasn't a clean first half. You're going to beat the defending champs, the number one team in the nation. It's got to be much cleaner in this second half.
Rocco saying you got to clean things up. Need to find a spark offensively. Hens won the toss, deferred for this moment. Getting the football first in the second half. Third quarter of action about to start with James Madison up 17-10. And Gene Coleman back to return for Delaware. We are underway on the squib kick as it bounces at the 30, picked up at the 25-yard line by Spruill, running to the right side at the 35. He's got some room at the 40, being chased at midfield. Down he goes into James Madison territory at the 47. So Corey Spruill hasn't gotten a carry in this game. The freshman, though, making his impact felt on special teams.
Well, I tell you what, that is a nice play by Spruill and a good break for Delaware because the ball kind of bounced around a little bit. I think that broke down the lane integrity for JMU in coverage. Start chasing after that football once it's on the ground. Lose your assignment. Spruill did a good job. Started one step left and cut back to the right. Bounced to open space and then used his running back instincts to take care of the rest.
Kane will start the second half as a running back next to Joe Walker. Kyle Yoakum also in the game on first and 10 from James Madison territory. And Kane, the leading rusher, he continues to be so hard to bring down. First contact came at about the 47. He got all the way up to the 44 before being brought down by Curtis Oliver.
Now that spin move, when you can run through tackles the way Kane is able to, and you add to it just a little bounce like that, and can kind of spin your way forward, that's a nice luxury to have for somebody his size with his power.
Split out to the left side. Jamie Jarman, Brandy Whaley with him, the tight end. Second down and six at the James Madison 43. First possession of the second half, and a quarterback run to the right side. Cutting is Joe Wong. Shimmy move gets him to the 40-yard line, about a yard and maybe 2 yards shy of a first down. So it'll be third down and two for Delaware.
I'd have to think, barring a backwards play here, this is two down territory. Only so many times you're going to get to start on JMU's side of the field and come away empty and be able to hang in this ball game. You've got to take advantage of these opportunities. We'll see, but I have a feeling this is two to get two.
It's third down and two, as discussed. We'll see if we don't have to worry about that, as Kenai Kane makes sure that there's no decision on fourth down. He gets a big hole up the gut and brought down by the safety, Brandon Herford, for the first down.
We're going to go quickly.
Up and under center is Joe Walker. Again, a carry for Kenai Kane, and Delaware maybe too fast for their own good as he gets stuffed, maybe lost a yard back to the 36.
Boy, they just blew up poor Brody Kern. He ended up 2-3 yards in the backfield. Connor Lutz got knocked on his backside, and there was just too much traffic in front of Kane, nowhere for him to go.
Looks like he ran into Brandon Whaley as well. That didn't help matters. So Delaware trying to go fast and get James Madison's defense out of sorts, and instead, they're at second down and 12, going backwards with 12:55, third quarter action. Kareem Williams into the ballgame as the running back, and Joe Walker going to run again up the gut. Gus Little on the tackle as he gets to the 32.
But that's a very important play there, to sneak his way inside to 32, make this a little bit more manageable. We proved in the first half that they are in field goal range already with the way Rago was able to knock one through. Still not a high percentage field goal, but they have the capability of kicking it this far. So certainly in a spot where you got to protect football first and foremost, but I think they'll trust Joe Walker. This is where he needs to be able to make plays with his arm.
Trips to the left side. Delaware 6 of 9 on third downs today. They need 7 from the James Madison 31. Looking left. Walker throws. Tight window, but Cherry makes it for the first down. Nice throw by Joe Walker and a beautiful reception between two white jerseys from Deontay Cherry.
Yeah, it's a good job to hold on there for Cherry. Knew he was going to take a hit, and that is a fantastic throw by Walker. That arm strength and put it through that tight window. A little high, but I think purposely thrown high to avoid the deflection with a man in his face. Good job by Joe there.
First and 10, 2 yards away from the red zone. Kenai Kane back in. He started the second half as the running back. Williams came in momentarily. Now Kane back in as Coleman goes in motion. Kane gets the ball, and he makes his way to the 16-yard line. Ball comes loose. James Madison signaling that they have the football.
Duke's got it.
And James Madison comes up with it. The fumble from Kenai Kane, and again, Delaware driving and giving the football up.
A fumble recovered by James Madison. First down.
You just cannot do that against the number one team in the country. We had Joe Walker throwing an interception as to end a Delaware drive, and now Kenai Kane fumbling the football and giving it away to James Madison. This is a JMU defense that is second in the CAA in turnovers gained on the season, coming in with 9, and just gotta help yourself.
I mean, what is that now? 3 possessions starting in JMU territory that you've managed 3 points off of? Can't have it.
Brian Shore will give to the leading rusher in today's game, Trey Sharp, to the outside. He goes at the 20-yard line, a pickup of 4.5 on first down.
Now it's on your defense to provide momentum yourself. Now you gotta find a way. The crowd certainly deflated.
It's as quiet as it's been here, man.
Yep.
Second down and 6 for Brian Shore. Low snap. Give is to Trey Sharp, this time running right. And Jalen Kindle with a great tackle as he got to the 22-yard line. Pickup of 3. It'll be 3rd down and 3 coming up for James Madison. Man down looks like Cam Kitchen after the play.
And Hens have had some injuries today.
Saw Casey Hinton, who's been big on special teams, go down. Charles Bell, we saw him being wheeled into the locker room. And now Cam Kitchen, who recovered a fumble for Delaware and has had a spectacular season thus far, a junior from Lawrenceville, New Jersey, a Newark Urgent Care injury stoppage here as he's being looked at the 30-yard line. 3rd down and 2 right now for James Madison as Kitchen gets looked at. And Delaware's got to get the football back. You got to make sure if you're going to turn the ball over, which the Hens have done, at least get back on the field without allowing the Dukes to score off of those turnovers.
Well, again, the Delaware defense, it hurt to give up 3 there at the end of the half when they were backed up inside their own 10. I think they started that drive at their own 7-yard line to James Madison. But this is the most potent offense in FCS. It's not close. And they've done a really solid job. I mean, 17 on the scoreboard, but 7 on a defensive score. As Kitchen is up, but is not putting much weight on that left leg, it looks like.
Yes, left leg not touching the turf as he's getting helped off the field. And already down a starter in Charles Bell. Already down a starter for the season prior to this game in Justin Watson. And now it looks like a defensive end, Cam Kitchen.
And the timing of the injury starts too, because you're coming off the bye week. You don't have another week to get healthy in your repertoire. You got 7 more CAA games to go after this.
That brings John Nassib into the game as we wish the best for Cam Kitchen. 3rd down and 2. Trips to the left side for Brian Shore. In motion goes Trey Sharp. From their own 23, it's Sharp, and he runs right into Nassib, who just checked in. Also, Troy Reeder was there. Big play by the junior from Westchester.
Was about to say, John Nassib is a pretty good guy to have as a backup. He has played a lot of football over the course of his Delaware career. And I think the best way to describe John Nassib is a destructive force. He can get his hands up in the passing lane because he's got such a long wingspan. He's tough to block and did a great job to shed the block. As a 5-yard penalty going to go against JMU here, but a great job to shed the block and make the tackle in the back.
54 on the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, 4th down.
The 54s on both teams have had some trouble in this game as Kelvin Azanama, the linebacker, gets penalized. Of course, Brody Kern, the 54 on Delaware's side, who's been penalized 3 times.
That was your name to say.
I appreciate you. Matt gave me a look that said, your turn. Rugby style again.
Oh,
he's going to keep it. He's going to keep it. He's going to run for it. He's going to get it. James Madison on the fake. Needed 7. He picked up about 9, and there's a flag thrown late.
Now, is that going to be dead ball, or is that going to be a personal foul in the middle of the play is the question here. It's a late, or it's an unnecessary roughness penalty against JMU. Is it a late hit, or is it during the play?
We'll find out.
Result of the play is a 1st down by James Madison. After the play, personal foul, late hit, out of bounds, number 24. Half the distance, 1st down.
Would have loved for that to come a little bit earlier as it would have prevented the first down conversion. But again, a fourth down conversion by an opponent of Delaware on some type of fake punt. It's the third time this season that Delaware has been beaten that way.
Well, you have to watch with a rugby-style kicker. More often than not, they always have the freedom. If they cheat a little bit too much on the return and there's nobody there on the corner, you can turn it up the field. I think that's exactly what happened. And that's just something that, I mean, the other two have been designed and pretty well executed fakes. That was a true breakdown on special teams that time from UD. But credit to this defense, they still look pretty emotionally enthused. This is a resilient bunch. Got to go to work again, lunch pail time.
Defense calling for some noise from this Delaware Stadium crowd. First and 10 back at the JMU 14-yard line. And it'll be Sharp again running into Kendall, Blaine Woodson, and company at the 15-yard line, maybe 16, gain of two. So James Madison converted the fourth down but lost yardage after the penalty. It's now second down, under 10 minutes to play, third quarter.
The deflating part about the fake, not only that your defense has to go back to work, but you were probably going to get the football plus territory again, punting into this type of wind.
Jamie Jarm was set up at midfield.
And you believe more clock when the wind's at your back where you don't have the ball.
James Madison up by seven. Sure play action. Throwing towards his sideline. Coming back to get it is Terrence Alls. His first catch of the season. The senior transfer from Duke was suspended the first four games of the season. He led JMU with four catches a season ago against Delaware, scoring on a 17-yard catch in that blowout win by the Dukes down in Harrisonburg. Now first and 10. Ball on the 27-yard line to James Madison. Trips to the left side for Brian Shore. Running back is Trey Sharp. And Sharp gets it again. Massive. Kendall in on the tackle. And Trey Sharp, how about that? He's been impressive today. We thought we'd see more of Marcus Marshall, the team's leading rusher, carries-wise, coming into today's game with 50 attempts on the year. But it's been Sharp who's up over 100 yards.
Sure, throw that ball a couple plays ago. He had negative one-yard passing into the wind in the first quarter. So that's his first throw into the wind, and it was a good one.
In motion goes Woods. Shore will keep it. Throwing down the middle of the field. Hyman goes to get it. It's deflected by Malcolm Brown and Ray Jones, both in the area. That's something Corey was talking about. Win one-on-ones, and it was Brown and Jones making it two-on-one.
And that's the safety coming over. Great timing there from Jones. The talk from Danny Rocco this offseason was he wanted to see his safeties have more eye discipline. Jones not sucked in on the play action, able to come over, almost intercepted that ball, but a fantastic job to break it up.
So it's third down and five, another third down for the Delaware defense against this James Madison team. They're 5 of 9 thus far today. Shore wants to throw. Here comes Jackson. He throws it to Hyman. He jumps to get it at the 45, runs to midfield, and now in Delaware territory. Down he goes at the 44. Another conversion on third down. Flag is thrown.
Hands were offsides. Missed time is corner blitz.
Offsides defense. Penalty will be declined. Result of the play, first down.
Malcolm Brown brought pressure and got across early. And unfortunately, in his attempt to try to avoid being offsides, he also slowed down, so there's no factor in the play. And that's the worst possible combination for UD.
Shore on first down from Delaware territory. Gives it to his running back. And Sharp again. And down he goes at the 41-yard line. Blaine Woodson, he's been active today, makes a stop. That was a 24-yard pass on third down to Ishmael Hyman.
UD has allowed JMU to flip the field here, but really the priority still remains avoid points. It's a one-score game. Got to find a way to keep it a one-score game.
10 plays on this drive already. That includes a fake punt conversion on fourth down. Sharp gets the carry on second and 7. Picks up 3 or 4, and it'll be third down. And again, short for James Madison. Looks like they want to go quickly on third down.
Here's where you worry about Delaware starting to wear down. You don't get to substitute as freely against this quick-paced JMU offense.
Sure, third down and 3. 7:15 to play, third quarter. They lead 17-10. The give is to Sharp. Sharp going to be stuffed on third down. As Troy Reeder and Bilal Nichols combine for the sack.
Have to think you go for it here if you're JMU. You never want to punt the ball from the 36. You'd be tempted to trust your defense. Hold your water here if you're Delaware. Don't give them a freebie by jumping.
They already converted on fourth down on this drive. Now Shore and the offense going to stay out on fourth down and two for the Delaware 36. 17 on the play clock as Shore looks over to the sideline, walks up to his offensive line, calls out the signals, trips to the right side. Alls by himself to the left of Shore. Shore throws, and Alls bobbled it and brought it down on the slant route at the 27-yard line. This conversion on fourth down.
And big cushion on the outside. Alls got inside position. Brown did a good job of closing the ball, just couldn't knock it all the way free.
Now James Madison going quickly with a handoff to Sharp, who bounces off of Bilal Nichols, gets his way to the 25-yard line. Pickup of two. Could have been a tackle for a loss by Nichols, but he just couldn't wrap him up.
Again, that's, I think, a sign of fatigue. It was a big hit, just couldn't get him down. And a lot of plays on the field in a quick, short span of time with this hurry-up offense.
14th play of the drive coming up as James Madison leads 17-10, 5:53 and ticking in the third quarter. Alls trying to turn the corner, but cannot. John Nassib gets some extra playing time because of the injury to Cam Kitchen, and he's making his time worthwhile out there. He's been active since coming in.
Well, the 3-4, it's normally the linebacker that you see setting the edge, but if you remember Nassib, when he was getting a little bit more playing time in the 4-3, he was really good at that himself. He would get to the outside, force the ball carrier back inside, and still make the tackle. He had a little flashback there, was able to pull it off.
John Nassib's a heck of a ball player. Now third down and 11 for James Madison. Empty backfield for Brian Shore, and a penalty flag is thrown.
Snap, delay a game, offense, number 17. It's a 5-yard penalty, third down.
Good to see JMU finally shoot itself in the foot. Delaware has had some self-inflicted wounds over the course of the afternoon. JMU, which has been so clean for the most part, outside of those two early turnovers in the first 5-6 minutes of the game, they're really hurting themselves here on this drive with a chance to get some big breathing room.
15 plays, 52 yards thus far on this drive. Now third down and 16 for JMU. Shore throws, caught at the 30 by Sharp. Jackson wraps him up at the 27-yard line. So well short of the first down. It'll be fourth and about nine.
They have to go. I can't see them kicking a 43-yard field goal into this win. So it's two down territory. So they were just trying to get a chunk back.
This drive has included two converted fourth downs by James Madison. It's fourth down and 9 right now for the Dukes. Trips to the left side. Sharp is a running back to the right of Shore. And Alls, who caught a 9-yard pass when they needed 7 on the last fourth down, is outside to the right. The CAA Offensive Player of the Year, Shore, takes the snap. Here comes Woodson, being chased as Shore by Nichols, throwing on the run towards the end zone. And Ray Jones hit the football down at the 1-yard line, flag thrown on the play. What an athletic move by Buck.
They're going to call it for pass interference, though. I think he went at a piece of the back of the jersey.
Defense, number 7. It's a 15-yard penalty. First down.
Closed hard on the football, and he made a pretty clean play up top with the right hand. But I think the left hand got caught in the back of the shoulder pad and was kind of keeping the receiver from jumping up. And he kind of catapulted himself up with that left hand, and that's what the official, the back judge, saw.
That explains the athletic move. He was kind of hanging in the air, and I think you're right. He pushed himself off on the receiver. Now a run to the left side, and a touchdown-saving tackle by Ray Jones as Marshall got to the outside at the 10. Ray Jones made the stop. Another penalty, though.
Number 70, offense. That's a 10-yard penalty. First down.
It's a huge penalty, though, Scott. They've got to find a way to get off the field empty here. And as silly as it sounds, back in 10 to the 21 or so, you're going to be right at the precipice of field goal range again. Now they've got 3 plays to get themselves back into field goal range, but 3 points is huge here. It really is, because JMU has bled the entire clock down. This is almost an 8-minute drive.
16 plays on the drive. It's included 3 fourth-down conversions, multiple penalties, and now first and 20 for James Madison. And a run goes to Marshall. We haven't seen him much today. 50 carries coming in, and he gets stuck for maybe a yard.
Again, a good job by that front. Blaine Woodson has played himself aware of a whale of a game, and then Ware, I thought, did a pretty good job coming in from the edge as well.
Second down and 20, no gain for Marshall. Marshall, the transfer from Georgia Tech, where he led the team in rushing over his first two seasons. It'll be Shore on play action. Throwing to Hyman, and Malcolm Brown got his hand in, but another flag.
Oh, I like the previous call. I thought it was a good one. I thought that's a pretty bad call. I thought they anticipated the contact that time. I thought Brown played the football pretty effectively.
Prior to the pass being thrown, holding number one on the defense. That's a 10-yard penalty.
Good call.
First down.
Good call. See, I watched a football come in. He made a great play on the football. He got beat, though, in the initial move and grabbed just a little bit of the jersey. I understand Brown's frustration, but unfortunately, it was a good call.
Makes it first down and 10 from the 11-yard line for James Madison after another penalty by Delaware. Shore wanted to lob it for the end zone, but when he wasn't looking, Jalen Kindle came sprinting in and got the sack.
Well, it's a lunch pail mentality this defense has, and also a next man up type of a prophecy today, because they've gone down. Unfortunately, they've had some injuries. Kindle having to step in for Charles Bell. He has given a fantastic effort. No Colby Reader on this drive. We've seen Ware in there, and Ware's had a great possession as well.
Second and 15 after the loss. On the Delaware 16-yard line, Trey Sharp back in as the runner. He spins as he gets to the 15. Down he goes at the 12, the original line of scrimmage. So he gets the loss of yardage back. Woodson in on the stop, and here comes third down and 10 for James Madison on what will be the 19th play of this drive.
I mean, you lost the entire quarter with the wind at your back. But you got to find a way to get one more stop here if you're Delaware, then figure it out after that.
2:07 and ticking, third quarter. A 17-10 lead for James Madison. Delaware showing some pressure. Here it comes. Short throws. Dropped by Alls at the 2-yard line. Nigel Hill in coverage. If Alls hauled it in, which he could have, it might have been a score.
They've been doing a pretty good job getting inside position. But Alls, that's his second drop today. And normally a pretty sure-handed receiver. And now a monumentally important field goal, because that drive felt like death by a thousand paper cuts, but it turns into an emotional bruising the other way if JMU can't get points out of it.
It'll be a 27-yard try into the wind by Tyler Gray. The holder is Hunter Etheridge. Tyler Gray's kick is no good, and Delaware survives the 21-play drive.
Wow.
What a stop. That's got to carry Delaware into this offensive drive coming up. What a job by the Delaware defense. 21 plays, 74 yards.
How many third down stops?
And fourth down conversions, and no points to show for it. We'll take a timeout with 1:53 remaining in the third quarter. Your PNC Bank timeout score, JMU 17, Delaware 10.
Me and you just singing on the train. Me and you listening to the rain. Me and you sitting on the lawn. Me and you just singing our song just to rhyme, to shine and to pass the time.
Step up to GMC and get nearly $10,400 total value on this 2017 GMC Sierra Denali Ultimate model. We are professional grade GMC.
Hi guys, it's great to be here.
In the desert.
At the mall.
On the mountain.
At school.
At the beach.
In the Big Easy.
Yeah.
Today I want to show you guys the next gen Chevy Equinox. What do you think?
That's pretty.
Pretty sexy.
It's all wheel drive, look at that.
It looks aggressive.
But not overbearing. It's not too big, not too small.
Looks like it could go off-roading.
But at the same time, it looks like a car you could take to a nice event.
You can dress it up or dress it down.
Seems like the perfect car for anybody.
I would take it anywhere.
I want one.
I love it.
She's a bad mamma jamma.
Chevy stepped their game up.
The official bird of Delaware isn't red. It's not green or purple. It's blue. Coincidence? We think not. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware. This blue hen does not need to see a podiatrist. But if he did, waiting for a referral might get his feathers in a bunch. And he wouldn't like that one bit. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware.
pressure on it, trying to push off in his three-point stance, and I saw him mouthing to his teammate saying, I hope so. He's trying to be optimistic to get back in this game. Also, Anthony Jackson was getting looked at. Seemed like he was just cramping up. So hopefully good news for the Blue Hens, who had certainly suffered some injuries earlier in this game.
That it would be good news if you can get those two guys back. They're very important cogs. But for Delaware defensively, JMU had 5 third downs, and the Hens were able to be successful on 4 of them. Now, granted, JMU converted on 4th down, but that's pretty impressive stuff against this type of offense.
Kane is the runner and running hard as he does. Contact at the 23-yard line. And Jordan Brown, 20 tackles on the season coming in, made the stop.
But the lift that provided this Delaware team, the emotion during the timeout, again, second or third time we've seen it, just everybody up. And oh, the importance of this game for Delaware, it's on so many different levels. A, the resume opportunity. B, just getting a win in conference. But C, kind of returning the national relevance, and this team wants it.
Second down and 7 as Walker will keep across the 25-yard line, and down he goes at the 26. Brandon Herford having a good day. He makes the stop, and now third down and about 5 to go for Delaware as we approach 60 seconds left in a very quick third quarter thanks to a 9-minute-plus drive for James Madison.
That was the big negative, though, to that possession. It is a 20 to 25-mile-an-hour win, and Delaware has it at their back for only 50 more seconds. That really is a disadvantage for UD, and a great job by JMU to bleed clock when they needed to.
JMU up 17 to 10. Walker turning, rushing, trying to find some space and has none of it. He'll lose a yard. Back to 25, and again, Brandon Herford right there. His first game of the season after serving a 4-game suspension and making up for lost time.
This is important, Scott. They got to hurry up and get this punt off before the end of the third quarter. It's like a 20, 25-yard difference in field position.
They have 15 seconds to get it off. Punt unit onto the field, and you're absolutely right, Matt. You want to be kicking with the wind to your back. It looks like they're set up. 7 seconds to get it off, now 6. Pritchard will punt this one away with 3 seconds on the third quarter clock. It's a good one. All's running for it. It'll bounce at the 32-yard line, roll a bit, and be down at the 22. So James Madison will take a 17-10 lead into the fourth quarter of action after a 52-yard punt by Nick Pritchard. We got a ball game. The number one team in the country taking on Delaware here in Newark, and there's 15 minutes left to decide a winner. Your Pepsi Bank timeout score, James Madison 17, Delaware 10.
Whether you're a morning person or simply it's not your thing. Maybe you're the type that doesn't take it that seriously. Or you're that person who just makes everyone's morning brighter. There's a McDonald's for every morning.
Enjoy a sausage burrito for $1 or a sausage McGriddle sandwich for $2. Pair it with any size freshly brewed McCafe hot coffee for $1.
Rush hour. Or relax hour. It's your choice. Ride more, save more, do more. Dart, moving forward.
Jones Shore on the offense. Sharp running up the middle, and he gets about six on first down. So a solid first down run by Trey Sharp, who's been very good today. Over 20 carries, 100 and almost 30 yards rushing. He's got five there. It'll be second down and five.
JMU has the safeties back about three or four steps further than what we were seeing going into the wind, because Shore obviously can just throw it over the top a little bit easier.
Shore has not had a busy day, only 93 yards passing. Sharp continues his busy day, though. First down yardage across the 35 and up to the 36-yard line before Malcolm Brown made the stop. Trey Sharp, this is not new for him. He had 130 yards rushing against Norfolk State.
But what it does is it takes more time for the safeties to come up and run support.
Trips to the left side, a whistle. Should be a false start against James Madison.
Prior to snap, false start. 13 on the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, first down.
That's Ishmael Hyman. 11 catches on the season coming in. Leading receiver in terms of how many yards per catch he gets. Averaging 15 yards per catch coming in. 25 yards a catch today for Ishmael Hyman, but he goes backwards after that penalty. First and 15 at the 31 in James Madison territory. On the QB draw, Brian Shore getting back up to the 35, so he gets four back out of the 5-day loss.
Well, the big difference, though, when you get that 5-yard penalty, because four is where JMU lives, and now with their ability to spread the field with the RPO, second and six is such a tough play to defend. Second and 11, it puts a lot more pressure on the offense to get something done here on this play.
Brian Shore out of shotgun, trips to the right side. Trey Sharp goes in motion on second and 11. It'll be Sharp sprinting to the left side. He's hit, spins off a would-be tackler and ducks to the 37-yard line. So third down and long. Nassib was there as well as Bilal Nichols, who I think made the first contact.
Again, Hens really struggled on third downs in the first half. We're really good on third downs in that last drive. They need a third down stop here.
You can see Casey Hinton sprint on. He was injured earlier in the day on special teams, but he's playing. That's a Newark Urgent Care injury update for you. Third down and eight for James Madison. They're 6 of 13 on third down today. Shore out of shotgun. His running back to his left. Trips to the right side. They need 8 yards from their own 38. Shore wants to throw. Has time. Running to the right side. Blaine Woodson was held up as Shore goes down the field. Hyman drops the football. Hill was in coverage, but that should be holding as Woodson was rushing the passer.
It absolutely will be. Hens here lucky that was an out-and-out setting.
The penalty is declined. Fourth down.
I thought Nigel Hill bear hugged the intended target that time, and I was very surprised not to see a flag. They'll call it guys jockeying for position. But that looked like more of a penalty than the one even we saw from Ray Jones on the previous possession.
Without the penalty, though, it stands. And Nigel Hill is just an impressive young man. His aggressive nature as a freshman to come in, step up for Justin Watson, he's played really well this
year. Yeah, he was in great position, and that might have been some of the reason why he didn't have the penalty called against him.
Hunter Gray faked the punt last time. He'll kick it this time. Low, line drive, rugby style. Jarman back to give it a try, and he takes it at the 10 or thought he was going to. He signaled prior to catching it at the 10-yard line, let it hop a few times, and now a little jawing going on after a 52-yard punt from Hunter Gray. Jamie Jarman didn't like how close one of the James Madison players got to him, and whistles being blown now. We'll take a timeout with 12:29 remaining in the fourth quarter. Delaware down by 7 with the football at 17-10. James Madison.
The best part about playing in the CAA.
The best part about playing in the CAA is
by far the competition.
All the competition.
Each week, you never know what's going to happen.
We've had multiple teams win national championships.
James Madison, kings of the FCS.
We got a lot of great players in this league who can make a play anytime.
When you have to prepare for the CAA teams each and every week, that's what prepares you for playoffs. I think that's what makes it the most dominant conference.
Hi guys, it's great to be here.
In the desert.
At the mall.
On the mountain.
At school.
At the beach.
In the Big Easy.
Yeah.
Today I want to show you guys the next gen Chevy Equinox. What do you think?
That's pretty.
Pretty sexy.
It's all wheel drive, look at that.
It looks aggressive.
But not overbearing. It's not too big, not too small.
Looks like it could go off-roading.
But at the same time, it looks like a car you could take to a nice event.
You can dress it up or dress it down.
Seems like the perfect car for anybody.
I would take it anywhere.
I want one.
I love it.
She's a bad mamma jamma.
Chevy stepped their game up.
We'll start at the 10-yard line, and here we go. Hens a chance to put a drive together and get some points on the board for the first time in the second half.
And right now, just need to find a way to get a first down. They've been hard to come by just one since intermission. Granted, not a ton of plays for Delaware, but you're going into the wind. You got a long field, but as you kind of alluded to, if you want to win this type of game, you've got to hit some big plays. Delaware's have one or two, but you got to get some more chunk yardage. Dan Rocco said, point blank, that was going to be one of the big keys. Could we find a way to get some explosive plays offensively?
Delaware just 187 total yards of offense, and that number is going to get smaller as Joe Walker on first down loses 2 yards to the 8. And again, Brendan Herfer, who we've been calling his name all game long, on the stop.
It is such a tough ask to throw the ball into the teeth of this wind, but Delaware might be forced to do it because JMU is just playing such an incredibly aggressive downhill nature of defense when the ends have been going in this direction.
In the pistol on second down and 12, Joe Walker give to Kenai Kane, who's gotten the chunk of carries today for Delaware, and he gets two back to the 10-yard line. 11 carries on the day for Kenai Kane, who's at about 73 yards thus far.
That problem you have now, though, is you'll pick up this first down. Game is going to start at like the 40-yard line, and all they need is a field goal to, I don't want to say salt it away because there's still time, but it would feel like salting it away the way Delaware's offense has been anemic in this second half.
Delaware has fared well on third downs today, 7 of 11, but they need 10 yards here.
Better hurry.
And the play clock is at 7 as they break huddle. They might have to use a timeout. 5 seconds, 4 now, as players are still in motion and there's too much confusion out there. Joe Walker has to call a timeout before the third down snap with 11:09 remaining in this ball game. Big third down and too much confusion out there on the field.
So you want to make sure you got yourself on the right page. It's too important of a play to kind of shoot from the hip, but I'm not sure what happened personnel-wise there. Delaware was stuck in the huddle for a long time. Danny Rocco was talking about trying to find some rhythm and some tempo offensively, and he hasn't been talking about going hurry up. They have tried that once or twice today, but it's more get in the huddle, get out of the huddle, get to the line of scrimmage ready to go. And that's something that has improved but crept up again at a bad time for UD right there because timeouts might be at a premium here as we go into this fourth quarter.
11:09 to play and Delaware down by 7, 17-10. 32nd time out, Delaware burns their first of the second half as Joe Walker comes back out. Trips to his right side, Jarman to his left. In motion is Cherry. He has Scarf on that side as well. Walker throwing. Bounces off the hands of Deontay Cherry. Would have been short of the sticks anyway. And it's fourth down for Delaware.
That hurts. You know, trying to get the ball to Cherry. A little bit high, a little bit to the outside. I'm sure Deontay will tell you when it hits his hands, he wants to be able to bring it in. But as you alluded to, when you throw it like that, there's not going to be any chance for him to run after the catch. And it would have been short anyway.
Out of the end zone, Pritchard will punt this one away. And some great field position likely coming up for James Madison. That one's high, and it gets stuck in the wind. Takes a Delaware hop from the 40 to the still rolling, perhaps 49, call it midfield. So a 39-yard punt by Nick Pritchard. And James Madison going to start this drive 50 yards away from the end zone. We'll take a timeout. 10:52 left to play. James Madison on 17-10. That's your PNC Bank timeout score. Stop.
Whether you're a morning person or simply it's not your thing. Maybe you're the type that doesn't take it that seriously. Or you're that person who just makes everyone's morning brighter. There's a McDonald's for every morning.
Enjoy a sausage burrito for $1 or a sausage McGriddle sandwich for $2. Pair it with any size freshly brewed McCafe hot coffee for $1.
Hi guys, it's great to be here.
In the desert.
At the mall.
On the mountain.
At school.
At the beach.
In the Big Easy.
Yeah.
Today I want to show you guys the next gen Chevy Equinox. What do you think?
That's pretty.
Pretty sexy.
It's all wheel drive, look at that.
It looks aggressive.
But not overbearing.
It's not too big, not too small.
Looks like it could go off-roading.
But at the same time, it looks like a car you could take to a nice event.
You can dress it up or dress it down.
Seems like the perfect car for anybody.
I would take it anywhere.
I want one.
I love it.
She's a bad mamma jamma.
Chevy stepped their game up.
Real estate solutions in the industry. Harvey Hanna and Associates is family owned and operated and a proud supporter of the University of Delaware. Visit harveyhanna.com.
I really feel like you're going to need a turn over here if you're Delaware, Scott. Certainly in a spot where you can't afford to give up points with the time and score down by 7, 10, 52 to go. Even a field goal makes this a two possession game. It's going to be tough for Delaware to score two times the way they have struggled. But it's also going to be tough for Delaware to score if they keep getting flipped back on their own side of the field. It is so tilted towards JMU now, with the Dukes getting the opportunity to start plus field position. UD was able to force some turnovers early. Can they go back to that well here?
First and 10 on the Delaware 49-yard line for Brian Shore in the offense. 24th carry of the game for Trey Sharp, and he wiggles his way to the 46-yard line. Pickup of three on first down for a very busy junior from North Carolina.
And we talked about all the depth for JMU. They haven't really needed it today. Only five guys have caught a pass, and only two backs have carried the football. It is mostly Ben Sharp using his legs and carrying the workload.
305 yards of offense for JMU today. Brian Shore on play action. Throwing into coverage, one-on-one ball, and it falls incomplete. It was to David Eldridge at around the 15-yard line. There was two Delaware players in the area.
Yeah, great coverage, Nigel Hill, but it was Nasir Adderley who did a fantastic job. Due to that safety position, he took a false step on play action, but a fantastic recovery. And that ball hung up there. Adderley almost picked it off.
Brian Shore, who throws for 72% on the season, is just 10 of 19 today. Third down and seven. Ball to Delaware 46-yard line. Shore looking. Here comes Nassif. Rolling. Running is Shore. Here comes Nichols. Still on his feet is Shore. Looking downfield. Nothing there. He'll run at the 45. Gets a blocker at the 40. Spinning and picking up the first down. What an athlete is Brian Shore, the senior from PA.
Hens rush three. Drop everybody else back in coverage. Did a great job umbrelling the field, giving Shore nowhere to go with the ball. The only problem is when you rush three, with Shore's athletic ability, he can extend plays. You had two guys with a shot at him, but Shore's just too elusive, able to make Nassif and Nichols miss, and then a couple of shifty moves to get the first down.
Seventh third down conversion of the day for James Madison. Sharp hit by Nichols as he gets down to the 34-yard line.
You said seventh, but that was the most costly, and it wasn't really close. That one, you can feel the air go out of this stadium right now, as you almost were rooting for him to be tripped up a yard or two shy, and then JMU keep the offense out there, and that would have been your opportunity to flip the field. Instead, now your back is really against the wall.
9:09 in second fourth quarter. JMU up by 7, 17-10 on the counter. It's Sharp, runs into a wall of blue jerseys at the 34. That's the line of scrimmage. It'll be third and 6.
Nothing. another good play by Kendall coming in. The run fits have been so solid for Delaware today. You worry about that against JMU because they're trying to get you to cheat to the outside, and Delaware has been really solid up the middle. Now you've got to find a way to get off the field here. It's right at the edge of whether JMU would try a field goal.
Jalen Kendall came in for an injured Charles Bell and has 10 tackles on the day. Third down and five for sure. He wants to run again. He'll get another first down. A flag comes late.
Jalen Kendall just drew a hole. Oh, and they didn't hold. The referee threw it from like 20 yards away.
Number seven, offense. It's a 10-yard penalty. Third down.
What a smart play by Jalen Kendall. Kendall attacked the receiver on the stop route at the stick. Short tucked it to run. And Kendall realized the leverage wasn't great, so he just threw his hands up in the air. And the referee standing 25 yards away saw it. It was such a small grab. It was a little bit of a tug. Kendall could have easily shrugged free of it, but because he knew he had no chance of getting Shore before he got the first down marker, he went into full acting mode, and he threw the penalty. Great play by Kendall.
That's a smart play from a smart man, a Delaware graduate with a finance degree, now at the UD MBA program, and that penalty makes it third down and 11 for James Madison back at the Delaware 39-yard line. Woods goes in motion from right to left. Four wide receivers, two to both sides. Play action. Shore going to roll out. Being chased by Nichols again. Flag is thrown. Here comes Nassib. Shore pumps, throws.
It's grounded.
Incomplete. That should be intentional grounding as no one was in the area.
We're near the line of scrimmage. He's out of the pocket, but he's got to get it back to the line of scrimmage. That ball landed 7 yards short of the line of scrimmage.
The flag was thrown well before the potential intentional grounding. The original flag. Let's take a listen.
60 on the offense. That penalty is declined. Intentional grounding, number 17. Ball be placed at the spot of the foul. Fourth foul.
And that's why it's important. It's a spot foul. So now instead of a high percentage chance to back Delaware inside the 10 or the 5, perhaps you can get this football out of the 15 or the 20, outside of the shadow of your own goal line. It's still going to be tough field position, but at least it's better than maybe it otherwise would have been.
Jamie Jarman back to return the punt as the intentional grounding penalty puts James Madison back in their own territory at the 47-yard line. Rugby-style punter in the game kicks this one away. Delaware had some pressure. It bounces into the end zone. A big break for Delaware as they'll take the touchback, giving themselves some room, and we'll take a timeout. Don't go anywhere. Delaware with the football back, down by 7. Your PNC Bank timeout score with 7:40 left. Duke 17, Blue Hens 10.
Saving money on Shell gasoline just got a lot simpler.
The official bird of Delaware isn't red. It's not green or purple. It's blue. Coincidence? We think not. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware. This blue hen does not need to see a podiatrist. But if he did, waiting for a referral might get his feathers in a bunch. And he wouldn't like that one bit. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware.
Hi guys, it's great to be here.
In the desert.
At the mall.
On the mountain.
At school.
At the beach.
In the Big Easy.
Yeah.
Today I want to show you guys the next gen Chevy Equinox. What do you think?
That's pretty.
Pretty sexy.
It's all wheel drive, look at that.
It looks aggressive.
But not overbearing. It's not too big, not too small.
Looks like it could go off-roading.
But at the same time, it looks like a car you could take to a nice event.
You can dress it up or dress it down.
Seems like the perfect car for anybody.
I would take it anywhere.
I want one.
I love it.
She's a bad mamma jamma.
Chevy stepped their game up.
We'll be right back. own 20-yard line. We welcome in a new quarterback, J.P. Caruso. Takes the snap and gives to Kenai Kane, trying to bounce to the outside. Gets the 24, first contact made at the 20, and he is so strong, churning those legs and picking up yak yards. It'll be second down.
Well, one of the things about Caruso, he's a little undersized, but they love the intangibles this kid brings to the table. New to the program this year, and yet when he arrived in summer camp, was an immediate leader that guys kind of gravitated towards, and they felt he really helped Joe Walker become more of an audible leader as well, kind of moving off of his example.
Delaware out of the pistol, give is to Kane, sprinting right side this time. And he picks up a few more at the 27-yard line.
Sometimes a change just provides a spark for everybody, not because of any other reason than you need a lift. And you know that there's that sense of urgency that the coaching staff has elected to try a different direction. We'll see what Caruso can do here on third and short. The nice part is the success on first and second down leaves the defense guessing here. It's not a third and must throw.
Third down and two out of the pistol. J.P. Caruso from his own 28-yard line gets a snap. He's going to throw the football. Pumping, does not have an open receiver on the run. Throws behind Jamie Jarman, and it falls incomplete. And so J.P. Caruso comes in, hands the football off twice. Throws an incomplete pass, and Delaware goes three and out.
We have said that a lot today. And that has been a recurring theme. Not a fun one, but it has happened too often. And, you know, Bilal Nichols came off, got a big hand from the crowd as he came off after that last punt, was just exhausted. And his entire defense has to be worn down.
Punt coming from Pritchard to the win. Running to catch it is Terrence Alls as he dives for it at the 45-yard line. That's a 27-yard punt by Nick Pritchard. And Delaware continues to struggle offensively against this James Madison defense. JMU will have great field position to start for the second drive in a row. 17-10, they lead, 6-11 remaining in the ballgame. And we'll take a timeout. That's your PNC Bank timeout score with 6-11 remaining here at Delaware Stadium on 94.7
WDF. Once it into the post to Nick Harris.
We've all been there.
I can't even see the score. Oh my God.
Trying to watch the game on that tiny screen. It's time to watch sports the way they were meant to be watched. On this, in high definition. You can now watch all your favorite teams and players on the big screen for free. With CAA.TV, you'll never miss a moment. Take back the living room by searching CAA on.
The official bird of Delaware isn't red. It's not green or purple. It's blue. Coincidence? We think not. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware. This blue hen does not need to see a podiatrist. But if he did, waiting for a referral might get his feathers in a bunch. And he wouldn't like that one bit. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield Delaware.
Separating them from success.
Trey Sharp, another carry. He bursts through the middle and picks up 10 on first down, maybe 9.5. He'll be just shy of the marker, it looks like.
Here's where you worry about the dam breaking on Delaware. The defense has really been resilient, but they have been out there for way too many plays in the second half.
It's second down and a yard for James Madison into Delaware territory at the 47. Sharp picks up that yard, gets a little bit more as he pushes the pile down to the 44. And that'll move the chain.
Now, some of it their own doing because they couldn't get off the field on the drive in the third quarter, but the rest of it is, I mean, the offense just can't buy a first down here. Since that possession, they have won.
148 rushing yards for Delaware, 47 passing yards for the Blue Hens. Not yet at 200 total yards, 195 today for Delaware. James Madison, 331 total yards, 238 on the ground. In motion goes Nick Carlton on first and 10 from Delaware territory. In the 29th carry for Trey Sharp, could be a big one. To the outside he goes, and he picks up 11 on a first down run to the 32-yard line.
I mean, you just look at Nichols. He is absolutely exhausted. They're acting, take him out of the game here. He's a warrior. He's trying to gut it out, but just so many snaps, and he is getting two bodies just pounded on him every single time. He's getting double teamed on essentially every play. It's so important to try to move that nose tackle.
Grant Roberts comes in to spell him as Hyman goes in motion on first and 10 for the Delaware 32-yard line. Sharp up to 30 carries. Flying in there is Troy Reeder to get the tackle for loss.
And boy, that was a big one. You needed some sort of a lift. You have time here. If you can rise up and get one more stop, this is right at the edge of field goal range for JMU. If you can get off the field here, you either force the Dukes to take a long field goal, or maybe they would go for it on fourth down because they don't like the percentages and they want to keep playing a field position game. But you're starting to see the clock become a factor with two timeouts and 4:20 to go.
17-10, James Madison leads. Second down and 11 for Brian Shore in this offense. Again, it's Sharp. Picks up a few to the 31-yard line, 2-yard gain. So it's third down and 9 for James Madison. The workhorse today has been Trey Sharp, 32 carries. He's close to 200 yards rushing, up to 180 after that give.
You mentioned earlier, career long is 44. Now, wind aided, certainly he's going to have more leg than that, but it would make it a low percentage kick. So if you can get a stop here, and then they try the long field goal, maybe that flips the field for you.
Third down and 9. JMU 7 of 15 on third down. Shore takes the snap. Flushed out of the pocket. Nichols showing some pressure. Now Ware in pursuit. Kobe Reeder from the backside gets the third down sack.
Well, the Hens have been rushing three on a lot of these third and longs. That time they brought five. Two linebackers joining in. Again, guess who? Nichols got the initial pressure. And then Reeder and Ware continue to stick with the play. And now here's your football game. If JMU makes this field goal, they're going to win. But if they miss this field goal, Delaware gets decent field position with time.
It'll be 48 yards for Tyler Gray into the win. Frank Rago made 55 into that same win for Delaware in the first half. To make it a two-possession game, the kick is up, and it's through for Tyler Gray, putting JMU up 20-10.
Great effort by the Delaware defense. Just such a small margin for error when the entire second half, or at least the entire fourth quarter, is played on that side of the field. And hence, the defense still only allowed the one first down on the drive, but just a little bit too much real estate churned up. And you know what, though? It's not over yet, 2:50 to go, and you still got two timeouts, but it was the type of step forward. This type of game where you came in saying, boy, you really hope Delaware could win, gets them back to where they want to be, but you wanted to see them be competitive with the best and show that they could play at that level and some belief and some confidence to bring off from this game. Defense has it. Defense gets that. They played a whale of a game. Offensively, you're going to kind of have to go back to the drawing board after this one. You thought maybe you were creeping closer. This was a big step backwards today. They have just done nothing in the second half. They have sustained no offense. They've been unable to even run plays because it's three and out, three and out, three and out. And then when they did put something together, they turned the ball over, which you could not afford to do. So the type of game it was is something that I think that there's some building blocks that you can be encouraged by. But offensively right now, it's still, it can be tough to watch at times because they just can't sustain anything, and it's so frustrating. You can see it on their expressions coming off the field. They can't put anything together.
And not to be overlooked, we talked about how good this James Madison defense is. A lot of talk goes to the offense. The defense is very good. But you wonder, you know, Coach Rocco and his staff able to analyze, look at personnel, look at packages coming in. And we haven't seen Thomas Jefferson or Kareem Williams very much. So you wonder if Kenai Kane becomes that every down back.
It seemed like
for this team, and he's done well, 81 yards rushing.
They seemed like they were mixing Kane and Williams early, and then Kane kind of took it over.
Yeah.
He had that one big run, a couple of tackle-breaking runs, and he kind of earned some more reps. But
on the stat sheet, he's the only thing standing out right now at 81 yards.
In the second half, look, you're down seven, and you have the ball with that big kickoff return by Spool in plus territory. And you had to take advantage of that. You turn the football over, and then you don't get the ball back, essentially, in the third quarter. It's like 3:45 to go when you get a chance with the wind at your back. That was the killer. I mean, we've only seen really one score with an offense going into the wind, and that was on that 59-yard run by JMU.
Kickoff by Gray after making the 39-yard field goal to make it a two-possession game. Goes out of the end zone. It's a touchback, and you know, Coach Rocco at the half said Delaware needed a spark offensively. They never got that, but now would be a good time with 2:50 remaining, and it's now a two-possession game, 20-10. And we're keeping an eye on that huddle to see who comes out of it.
This could be Caruso.
At the last possession, J.P. Caruso, the transfer from App State, came in, and he'll stay in. Helmet off for Joe Walker, who was 5 of 11 today, but really missed some throws and had that interception when Delaware was driving. So Delaware's offense on the field to start at their own 25-yard line with J.P. Caruso. 0 of 1 today, 2 of 4 as a Blue Hen. Dropping back the pass. Caruso throws it high, caught by Scarf at the 30-yard line, dragging a defender for first down yardage up to the 36.
Well, obviously got to go fast now. And if you're Caruso, you probably look at this as an audition, too.
It's a tryout.
Yeah, you play well, maybe this could be your job.
First and 10 at the 37. Snap to Caruso. Throwing middle of the field for Scarf again. Overthrows his target that time. Looking for a flag with Scarf. Didn't get one as Jordan Brown, the senior safety, was in cover.
A lot of clutching and grabbing there. Little seam route. Scarf had a step, and then all of a sudden he didn't. Now Brown isn't a slow guy, but neither is Scarf. So either Brown caught up or he was grabbing him the whole time. And on the replay, sure looked like he was grabbing him the whole time.
J.P. Caruso. Transfer from App State said he saw Delaware as an amazing opportunity with a great NBA program and football tradition, and he's got a chance, if they could do something on this drive, to be the new quarterback of this Blue Hens team. He throws, and that's incomplete. Pressure was coming. He was looking for Papali at around the 45-yard line.
I mean, the other thing, too, in both of these quarterbacks' defense, not a ton of openings. I mean, you kind of blanket the field, and you got a lot of guys blanketed on Delaware wide receivers. There are not big windows to throw into and not a ton of time to kind of survey your options. That's a bad combination.
JMU leads the CAA, 11th in the country, coming in pass yards allowed.
And those numbers are probably going to go up after today.
Only 59 pass yards for Delaware. It's third down and 10 after the incomplete pass. Caruso has some time this time, but it closed quickly. That time to throw the football. Darius Carter with the sack. The transfer from Virginia, one of the many transfers on this team. He gets a sack there, and it's fourth down and 18 now for Delaware. And of course, they got to try it on fourth down, down by 10, 2:04 and ticking.
He just ran right past Jethro Pepe, who tried to hold him to save Caruso from the big hit. Just missed.
Hens need 18 to continue this game. Caruso shuffles his feet, steps up in the pocket, throws behind his man, Deontay Cherry, and it falls incomplete. And I'll tell you what, neither quarterback came in and looked very good today. That's a turnover on downs, and James Madison is going to remain the number one team in the country.
Kind of a fitting end to the day for Delaware, where one side of the ball stood toe-to-toe with the best. The other side of the ball has some work in front of them, and you worry about the side of the ball that had the success today because they paid for it with some injuries. We saw a lot of guys go out. The two most concerning, Kitchen and Bell, it seemed the most severe.
Sure, we'll go out of shotgun with a minute 50 remaining in the ball game, and Sharp gets another carry. Blaine Woodson's had a heck of a day. He makes a tackle there. Woodson with 12 tackles. This defense is phenomenal, and they've played so well, and Delaware's offense just unable to get anything when they've had the football. But Blaine Woodson, he's had quite the career. Started off as Rookie of the Year in the CAA and never quite became that all-CAA perennial player, but he has a chance to do so if he continues some of the great work he's done as a senior from Stroudsburg, Pennsylvania. The 21-year-old doing a nice job today and 12 tackles. He had 8 tackles in the first 3 games of the season, so he's played well. Reeder, 12 tackles. Kindle, 10 tackles. Anthony Jackson with 8 tackles. There's a lot of individual great efforts as well as team efforts on this defensive side.
Yeah, I mean, and that's the thing. This is the best team you're going to play on the schedule outside of Virginia Tech. So perhaps the offense will be able to hold its own better against some of the later competition. But the defense is a playoff defense. It is good enough on that side of the ball.
Sure, with the give to Sharp. Nichols wraps him up. Jackson came over to help. It'll be third down and about 3 for James Madison at the Delaware 22-yard line, 1:34, and it'll stop ticking as Delaware will burn their final timeout, down by 10, 20-10, 94 seconds left.
Sorry about that, Scott, but when you look at the stats and you kind of think back about how this game unfolded, you almost scratch your head and wonder how this was competitive for as long as it was. I mean, Delaware, I think their last first down came with 12, 13 minutes left in the third quarter. I don't know if they have one since then. It has been a lot of 3 and outs, that's for sure. Defense has had to play so many snaps, and almost all of them have come on their side of the field.
Delaware, a team that is 3rd in the country in time of possession, having the football for an average of 37 minutes per game. They've had the football for only 25 today, 33 for James Madison.
Which is really alarming, because JMU averages like 11 seconds between snap. They almost never win time of possession.
Third down and 3. We'll see if Sharp gets his 35th carry of the season, of today's game. He does so. He can't bounce the outside. Colby Reeder is there. Those Reeder boys are fun to watch. Colby with the tackle that time. And a tackle for loss by Colby. The 7th tackle for loss by the Delaware defense. But now Delaware without timeouts. This will start to click down.
I mean, JMU scored 75 on Norfolk State a couple of weeks ago. I think their time of possession average advantage was like 2.5 minutes. I mean, that's how fast they go between snaps. So for them to have a 9-minute advantage tells you how they dominated the football and the plays. Chip Kelly was always fond of saying it doesn't matter how long you have the football in terms of the clock. It matters how many plays you get to run. JMU ran a lot more plays than Delaware today.
I think 37, maybe closer to 40 now, plays in this second half for James Madison. They let the play clock run down to 47 seconds left in this ball game and call a timeout. 2 timeouts left for James Madison. They won't need them, obviously. But JMU doubling up Delaware in this game. And don't forget, after this ball game, we've got the American Spirit Federal Credit Union post-game show for you. We'll hear from head coach Danny Rocco. Corey Nida will have him. We'll also have final stats for you and analyze this game. And then we'll look forward to Stony Brook when you look at the schedule, and we'll talk more about it in the post-game show. Could be the best true test of where Delaware stands in terms of not playing an FBS powerhouse that has a chance to get into the top 10 in FBS football with a good showing tonight against Clemson and the number 1 team in the country out of the FCS level. Mix in there Del State and Cornell teams that are not a top 25 caliber team. So
not top 100.
Yeah, I was being kind. That's more accurate.
I'm not in the mood to be kind at the moment.
Yeah, it's been a tough day. Secondly, certainly a tough second half for this Delaware team. Down by 10, 20-10. And on 4th down and 4, JMU will go for it. Trying to turn the quarter is Trey Sharp. He won't be able to do so. So Delaware will get the football back with 41 seconds left. The turnover on downs. And
you do have to respect this team. So the way that
they're phenomenal.
Tunnel vision towards everything else that's going on. Delaware as a team has 3 first downs in the second half. I believe 2 accrued on penalties. And they have lived on the field. This game is over, decided. They're tired. They're worn down. They have lost bodies due to injury. And they're still getting themselves off the field. And that's, you can't question the heart. That's for sure. They are. They are a mentally and physically tough, tough bunch.
An offense that has no first downs in the fourth quarter. Back onto the field, down by 10. J.P. Caruso is the quarterback. He's one of five today, and he waited too long to get rid of the football. He'll be sacked at the 24-yard line. Looked like David Ezogwu made the stop.
He wanted to get the ball down the field to Cherry, and unfortunately on that post, there were just two guys sitting center of the field. Caruso couldn't pull the trigger.
Second down and 10, Caruso. Again, looking to throw. Pressure coming. Caruso has some room to run. Doesn't want to do so. Instead, throws on the run. Looking for Coleman. Hit his hands, but good coverage by Raven Green to knock it loose. Flag was thrown back towards the line of scrimmage. Hear from the official.
Yeah, legal forward pass over the line of scrimmage. Number 9. It's a 5-yard penalty. From spot of the foul. Also loss of down. Third down.
12 seconds remain, and Caruso came in on the final three possessions for Delaware now. 1 of 5, 12 yards. Joe Walker, 5 of 11, 47 yards and a touchdown, but an interception. And a lot to work on offensively for this Delaware team as they will get ready for Stony Brook and their first visit to New York to take on Stony Brook as a member of the CAA.
What's the old expression? It's never as good as it looks. It's never as bad as it looks. I think you have to hope that's apropos here.
I think that's what it is. You've played a bad Delaware State team, an extremely good Virginia Tech team, a bad Cornell team, and now an extremely good James Madison team. So the panic button should not be pressed because you didn't beat the number one team in the country, the defending national champion. So I agree with you, man.
No, absolutely not. It's just concerning how little they were able to move the ball. And I think Danny Rocco will talk about that after the game. This will be the last snap. They had a 10-second run off.
Caruso will throw for the final time today, and a pass is caught by Jamie Jarman down at midfield. So that'll pad the stats a bit, but that's all it'll do. Delaware falls 20-10 to James Madison. The Dukes will remain the number one team in the country.
Little
couple players talking.
Frustration there at the end. Good job by both coaching staffs to get in the middle and put the kibosh on that right away.
And I'll tell you, a lot of respect with this handshake at midfield as Danny Rocco had very kind things to say about Mike Houston when he spoke with the press earlier in the week. So,
and you could tell there's mutual respect. There's a lot of connections as well. And Danny Rocco spent a lot of time in the state of Virginia when he was at Richmond and Liberty before that. And I'm sure a lot of recruiting battles as well over the years. And look, Danny Rocco has work in front of him. I think he knows that. He understands the fact he has a defense that can win now and an offense that's probably a little bit away from being a winning type of an offense. But he's got to go back to the drawing board and find a way to kind of hide that offense as much as possible, feature the defense. The biggest thing for Delaware is they can't have field position happen the way it did today. You can't. They're not an offense. We talked about not being able to convert on third and longs. They're not an offense that's built to go 90, 95 yards. And I mean, it felt like every possession of that second half, they started at their own 20 or inside. And they're just not equipped to do that yet. You want them to get there, but they're not there yet, especially against this type of defense. And so that'll be something that they have to harp on. The defense played an incredible game. There was just one drive that really cost Delaware. Now, it was an incredible piece of resilience that they were able to survive it without giving up points. But it cost Delaware the whole third quarter, and that was the point in the game where you were going to have a chance to maybe get something done with the wind at your back, going into the wind with the limitations you already have. That's a tall ask, and as we saw play off, it was just too much to ask for Delaware to be able to get it done. That's really the only fault you can find in that side of the ball. Pretty much everything else, they were...